Bonjour. Good evening, everybody. Take a seat, please. Tout le monde prend place. Nous allons commencer. We start now. Honorable ministre, Excellences, distingués délégués, Mesdames et Messieurs, bonjour. Je déclare la quatrième plénière de la quatrième session de l'Assemblée des Nations Unies pour l'environnement ouverte. L'ordre de la séance est déterminé par la liste des orateurs. Si vous avez besoin de consulter la liste, veuillez vous rapprocher de notre agent de conférence qui pourra vous aider. Avant d'inviter notre premier orateur, je souhaite rappeler à nos délégués que durant la séance plénière de mardi, il a été décidé qu'un minuteur serait installé à la gauche de chaque orateur, afin de lui permettre de surveiller son temps imparti de 3 minutes, lors de son discours. Le microphone s'éteindra automatiquement après le temps imparti et un court délai de grâce. J'exhorte tous les délégués à faire leur déclaration dans le temps imparti. Les vidéos et les textes des déclarations seront publiés sur le site web de l'Assemblée pour l'environnement. Je souhaiterais également rappeler aux délégations qui n'ont pas encore envoyé la version écrite de leur déclaration au secrétariat de le faire au plus vite. J'ai maintenant l'honneur d'inviter Monsieur le ministre de l'Eau et de l'Environnement du Yémen, Monsieur Eizi Ibat Alal Ali Shouraïm. Excellence, vous avez la parole.
السيد رئيس جمعية الأمم المتحدة. السيد رئيس جمعية الأمم المتحدة للبيئة. السيدة المديرة التنفيذي بالإنابة لبرنامج الأمم المتحدة للبيئة. أصحاب المعالي الوزراء السيدات والسادة جميعا أسعد الله أوقاتكم بالخير اسمحوا لي في البداية أن أتقدم بالشكر والتقدير العميقين لجمهورية كينيا على كرم الضيافة وحفاوة الاستقبال الذي حظينا به منذ اللحظة الأولى لوصولنا هذا البلد الكريم كما نبارك مرحبين هنا بالسيدة أنجر أندرسن بتعيينها مديرة تنفيذية جديدة للبرنامج ونتمنى لها التوفيق في عملها الجديد سيدات والسادة إنه لشرف لي أن أكون بينكم اليوم في هذه القمة الرابعة للبيئة والهامة بالنسبة لنا جميعا بل والأكثر أهمية بالنسبة لمستقبل الأجيال القادمة الذي نؤكد لهم بأننا سنعمل كل ما بوسعنا من أجلهم ومن أجل ضمان المستقبل وأود في مستهل الحديث التأكيد بأننا نؤيد المواضيع التي تبنتها الجمعية لهذا العام والتي تتعلق بالابتكارات في مجال استدامة الموارد كما نؤكد على كل ما طرحته مجموعة الدول العربية ملاحظات على البيان الوزاري وكذا شكرنا لجميع الدول على دعمها للمشاريع المقدمة للمجموعة العربية سيدات والسادة إن بلادي تتعرض بصورة مستمرة للعديد من الكوارث الطبيعية وغير الطبيعية ففي الكوارث الطبيعية الناجمة عن ظاهرة التغير المناخي
أصبحت حقيقة نشاهدها ونسمع عنها ونعيشها كل يوم. فعلى سبيل المثال للحصر، ازدادت وتيرة الأعاصير التي تعرضت لها اليمن خلال السنوات القليلة الماضية. فخلال الأربع سنوات ما بين 2015 إلى 2018 تعرضت بلادنا إلى 5 من الأعاصير القوية المتتالية التي ضربت عدد من مدننا الساحلية، ومن بينها جزيرة سقطرى ومحافظتي المهرة وشبوة. وقد نتج عنها خسائر فادحة في الأرواح والمنازل والممتلكات والبنية التحتية، وتدهور كل سبل ومصادر العيش بالنسبة لمجتمعنا الذي يمثل منه السكان الريف حوالي 70%، ويعتمدون اعتماداً كلياً على الأنشطة الزراعية. كما أن التغير في كميات ومواسم الأمطار أصبحت ملحوظاً ويؤثر إلى حد كبير على تدهور الأراضي والتربة والموارد الطبيعية والتنوع الحيوي. كذلك فإن موجات الغبار تزداد إلى حد كبير بسبب الكثير من المشاكل، مسببة الكثير من المشاكل الصحية التي تشكل عبئاً إضافياً على صحة المواطنين. أما الكوارث المدعومة، أما الكوارث غير الطبيعية، فتتمثل في تلك التي تقوم بها ميليشيا الحوثي الإنقلابية المدعومة من إيران، والتي بلغت حداً كبيراً من العبث والتدمير الذي طال الإنسان والأنظمة بكل مكوناتها في البر والبحر. ففي الوقت الذي نحن هنا نمد أيدينا لنتعاون من أجل البحث عن كل السبل للسلام المستدام ولإيجاد الحلول الممكنة للقضايا العالمية من أجل المستقبل أجيالنا القادمة، فهناك في اليمن ميليشيات تزرع آلاف الألغام لتشكل تهديداً يومياً للأبرياء، بل وتبقى لسنوات وعقود لتحصد أرواح الأجيال القادمة. السيدات والسادة، بالرغم من كل الظروف والتحديات، فقد حرصت بلادنا أن تستمر في جهودها بكل ما يتاح لها من إمكانيات، وأن تشارك المجتمع الدولي في جهوده المستمرة للحفاظ على البيئة. لقد حرصت بلادنا على العمل والتعاون مع جميع المنظمات المختصة بالبيئة، وخلال السنين الماضية الذي كان عدد من
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre. J'ai maintenant l'honneur d'inviter à présent Monsieur le Ministre de l'Environnement et du Développement Durable de la Colombie, Monsieur Ricardo Lozano.
Muchas gracias, señor presidente. Distinguidos jefes de Estado y de Gobierno, ministros, embajadores y jefes de delegación, señoras y señores, me uno a los sentimientos de solidaridad con las familias y amigos de las víctimas del triste accidente aéreo del pasado 10 de marzo. Asimismo, quiero expresar mi agradecimiento al Gobierno de Kenia por su hospitalidad, al señor ministro Eldin Kiiler de Estonia y presidente de la Cuarta Asamblea de Naciones Unidas para el Medio Ambiente por su liderazgo y dedicación, y a la Secretaría del PNUMA. Para Colombia es fundamental que las discusiones que se den en estos escenarios multilaterales se basen en los hallazgos de la ciencia e investigación, así como el conocimiento tradicional de nuestras comunidades que nos permiten vincular con retos locales, nacionales y globales, con la toma de decisiones innovadoras e integrales para alcanzar las metas de los procesos de consumo responsable y producción sostenibles. En Colombia hemos trazado el camino que busca la convivencia armoniosa entre las actividades productivas y la conservación del capital natural, producir conservando y conservar produciendo. Este es el objetivo del Pacto por Colombia, Pacto por la Equidad del presidente Duque, que busca impulsar acciones del sector público y privado, de las autoridades territoriales, las instituciones y la sociedad civil para adoptar prácticas ambientalmente sostenibles, bajas en carbono y resilientes a los desastres y al cambio climático, todo soportado en un marco institucional ambiental moderno, en diálogos basados en el conocimiento y la información y en una cultura ciudadana que valora su biodiversidad, sus páramos y humedales como activo estratégico de la nación. Para dar cumplimiento al Pacto y a la Agenda 2030 y sus Objetivos de Desarrollo Sostenible, el país fue pionero en la región lanzando la primera Estrategia Nacional de Economía Circular, la cual busca garantizar modalidades de consumo y producción sostenible a través de la reducción de la intensidad en el uso de materiales y aprovechamiento de las oportunidades para incrementar el reciclaje y la reutilización. El modelo que consta de pactos territoriales y sectoriales pretende aumentar la circularidad en el ciclo de vida de los productos a través de repensar, reutilizar, reparar, restaurar, remanufacturar, reducir, reproponer, reciclar y recuperar el producto y material de los procesos industriales. En el sector energético, por ejemplo, nos habíamos propuesto al final del gobierno la entrada de nuevos 1.500 megavatios provenientes de energía solar y eólica y ya lo hemos logrado con la nueva subasta de energía del Ministerio de Minas y Energía del país. También hemos creado la Mesa Nacional de Gestión Integral del Plástico con la definición de metas graduales de reducción en la producción y uso de los plásticos de un solo uso. Seguimos incrementando los negocios verdes desde nuestros mega diversos territorios con la generación de productos y servicios innovadores con la conservación y uso sostenible de la biodiversidad. Colombia considera prioritario incrementar nuestras ambiciones y avanzar en la negociación del marco mundial de la biodiversidad biológica posterior al 2020. E invitamos a los demás Estados miembros a participar activamente en este vital proceso. Lamentamos profundamente que en esta Asamblea Mundial de Naciones Unidas para el Medio Ambiente no hayamos acordado la adopción de una resolución que luche contra nuestro más grande problema, la deforestación, que destroza más de 220.000 hectáreas en el año en nuestros territorios, especialmente territorios tan vitales para la humanidad como son los parques nacionales naturales de la Amazonía y la región pacífica colombiana. Ante este panorama, este gobierno está comprometido en frenar de manera definitiva la tasa creciente con programas de intervención local y emprendimientos sociales y económicos con el apoyo de Noruega, Suecia, Suiza, Alemania y Reino Unido, entre otros países. Señoras y señores, quiero finalizar invitando a todos los Estados miembros a que nos comprometamos a implementar de manera inmediata las soluciones innovadoras que hemos pactado durante esta vital y crucial asamblea. Muchas gracias.
Je remercie son excellence Ricardo pour sa déclaration. J'invite à présent le ministre José Herrera, ministre de l'Environnement, du Développement durable et du Changement climatique pour Malte.
Mr. President, ministers, ambassadors, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure and honor to be able to address at this important occasion of our global environmental gathering. I would like to start by expressing Malta's solidarity with the families and friends of the victims of the Ethiopian Airlines plane crash. Now back to the subject. We now all fully recognize that economic growth cannot be sustainable if it is achieved at the expense of social progress and environmental protection. We need to ensure that government's policies, strategies and initiatives are guided by the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. Establishing an ambitious and long-term sustainability policy is key for progress. And this is what the Maltese government is doing through the development of a new sustainable development strategy with a horizon up to 2050. Sustainable production and consumption are a prerequisite for a sustainable and prosperous future for all the world's people. Despite its evident limitation in relation to size and topography, Malta can't continually seek to translate towards a more circular economy to develop sustainability. Cognizant of the efforts required, the Maltese government is currently finalizing legal provisions to institutionalize the notion of circular economy in our country. The provisions will emphasize government's duty to foster the transition towards and the subsequent growth and development of circular economy. It also enshrines a duty of the citizens to, as much as possible, ensure that in all activities partaken, efforts are made to minimize waste generation and that any waste produced does not harm the environment. Other initiatives that are in the pipeline include a strategy on single-use plastics. The strategy will aim at promoting better sustainable consumption patterns. These will be complemented by various other sectorial policy frameworks, such as the regulation of commercial waste and the separate collection of pharmaceutical waste. And this after introducing compulsory separation of household organic waste last year. It is time for taking concrete action. The longer we wait, the more expensive it will be for our country to readjust. Small economies have limited economies of scale, and this results in limited investments by private firms in R&D. The Maltese government is addressing this through various initiatives for the promotion and expansion of industry and the development of innovative enterprises. Being the largest consumer, government plays a key role in the market. Hence, the Maltese government launched the second Green Public Procurement Action Plan. This confirms the government's intention to lead by example. In doing so, it is hoped that the private sector will follow suit and shift its procurement towards greener practices. The financial sector has a key role to play in this much-needed transition. Indeed, Malta has undertaken a study to assess those green financial instruments that are best suited to incentivize more take-up of greener and more sustainable production and consumption patterns. Thank you.
Je remercie Son Excellence Herrera pour sa déclaration. Honorable ministre, excellences, distingués délégués, mesdames et messieurs, en raison de circonstances imprévues, monsieur le ministre Camille Robinson-Régis de Trinidad et Tobago a demandé à faire sa déclaration légèrement plus tard, à moins qu'il y ait d'objections majeures, j'aimerais inviter le ministre Marcelo Mata, ministre de l'Environnement de l'Équateur, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, monsieur le ministre.
Señor presidente, en nombre del gobierno del Ecuador, en mi calidad de autoridad ambiental, es un honor participar en la cuarta Asamblea de Naciones Unidas para el Medio Ambiente con la calurosa bienvenida del gobierno de Kenia en esta sede, a quien extendemos nuestro agradecimiento por su hospitalidad. Permítanme presentar una breve reseña del Ecuador como uno de los 17 países más megadiversos. Contamos con las dos terceras partes de la biodiversidad del planeta y la mayor biodiversidad por kilómetro cuadrado. Al igual que la gran mayoría de los países en desarrollo, nuestras riquezas naturales han sido afectadas debido a presiones generadas por diversos mecanismos de producción, mercado, altos índices de pobreza, circunstancias que estamos sobrellevando y en eso aún requerimos de apoyo internacional en materia de financiamiento, transferencia de tecnología y desarrollo de capacidades. El Ecuador cuenta con una constitución garantista de los derechos de la naturaleza, la primera en el mundo, con mecanismos que incluyen entre sus objetivos acoger procesos, tecnologías y demás instrumentos que le permitan al Estado establecer el desarrollo sustentable y la armonía del ser humano con la naturaleza. En este contexto, resalto el programa emblemático Reverdecer Ecuador, enfocado en la conservación de nuestra biodiversidad y su aprovechamiento para generar alternativas de desarrollo sustentable y nuevos modelos de producción más amigables con el planeta. El año pasado presentamos nuestro examen nacional voluntario y el señor presidente de la República, Lenín Moreno Garcés, declaró como política pública del Gobierno Nacional, mediante decreto ejecutivo, la adopción de la Agenda 2030 para el Desarrollo Sostenible y sus 17 objetivos. En mi país, la producción limpia y el consumo responsable fue creado hace 10 años con el apoyo del Programa de Naciones Unidas para el Medio Ambiente. promoviendo la implementación del proceso a través de incentivos ambientales establecidos bajo la marca Punto Verde, contribuyendo a tener cultura de optimización de recursos naturales y sin plásticos en los ríos y el mar. Salvemos a Galápagos. Muchas gracias.
Remercie son excellence Mata pour sa déclaration. J'invite à présent le ministre Carole Dieschbourg du Luxembourg, ministre de l'Environnement, du Climat et du Développement durable. Vous avez la parole, Madame la ministre.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Chers collègues, excellences, Mesdames, Messieurs, tout d'abord, j'exprime mes très sincères condoléances aux proches des victimes du terrible accident d'avion. Et puis j'aimerais de tout cœur remercier tous ceux qui ont préparé cette UNEA 4 ainsi que le gouvernement du Kenya pour son hospitalité. Mon intervention est en ligne avec celle faite de ma collègue roumaine, faite au nom de l'Union européenne. La pression globale sur les ressources naturelles engendre une dégradation énorme des écosystèmes, de la biodiversité et du climat, ce qui touche non seulement les plus vulnérables, mais toute la communauté mondiale. Je salue vivement donc le thème choisi par l'UNEA 4 qui nous rappelle notre devoir de changer. Changer nos modes de consommation et de production afin de garantir un environnement propre et la santé de nos citoyens. Nous avons tous une obligation collective qui consiste à passer le plus vite possible à une économie innovatrice, circulaire et sobre en carbone. Nous avons l'obligation de protéger le climat, protéger nos ressources, nos forêts et lutter contre toutes sortes de pollution. Accélérer la transition vers une société et une économie résiliente ne se limite pas à l'innovation technique, mais comporte également le passage à un modèle de réutilisation et de partage. Il faudra créer des nouveaux partenariats entre le monde scientifique sur base de données environnementales fiables, accompagnées d'indicateurs solides et robustes. Permettez-moi de vous faire part des quelques expériences du Luxembourg pour mettre en œuvre l'accord de Paris et l'agenda 2030. Notre nouveau plan de développement durable est un instrument garantissant la cohérence des politiques. Il a été élaboré avec la société civile et les partenaires privés et publics, parce que la transition, ça se fait par tout le monde. Ainsi, chaque nouvelle législation et réglementation sera soumise à un examen de durabilité, aussi bien que chaque nouvelle entreprise. L'économie circulaire est une opportunité énorme pour la protection de l'environnement et des consommateurs si elle est accompagnée d'une gestion durable de produits chimiques. Une stratégie zéro waste sera élaborée, aussi bien que le stop à l'usage unique de plastique. Le gouvernement du Luxembourg s'est engagé très fortement en la matière de finances durables. Et pour réorienter nos flux financiers, la Luxembourg Sustainable Finance Roadmap a été élaborée en partenariat avec l'initiative financière de l'UNEP, le secteur financier et les ONG. Chers collègues, nous avons le devoir de protéger les défenseurs des droits de l'homme, de protéger les activistes environnementaux et je suis en accord avec les ONG. Et enfin, permettez-moi de rappeler, de souligner l'importance d'avoir toute la société, l'égalité des genres, les femmes, parce que sans les femmes, sans tout le monde, aucune véritable transition écologique et solidaire ne se fera. Et finalement, je m'engage à entendre toutes les voix de la société civile, des ONG, des peuples indigènes et surtout des jeunes qui nous obligent à agir. Sachez donc que le Luxembourg continuera de faire partie des pays ambitieux. Je vous remercie.
On remercie son excellence le ministre Dieschbourg. Alors une fois de plus, en raison de circonstances imprévues, le ministre du Guatemala, Alfonso Rafael Alonso Vargas, a demandé à faire sa déclaration légèrement plus tard. À moins qu'il y ait d'objections majeures, j'aimerais inviter monsieur le ministre Ricardo de Aquino Sales, ministre de l'Environnement du Brésil. Vous avez la parole, monsieur le ministre.
Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen, the Brazilian delegation presents its solidarity to the United Nations organizations and member states officials victims of the terrible plane crash, which left us shocked and deeply sad. We have only one Earth, where 7.7 billion depend on its resources. Using these resources sustainably is not an option, it's mandatory. The world needs solutions that simultaneously allow for economic and protect environment for the current and future generations. Today, 55% of the world population live in urban areas. Tackling the environmental impacts of urban living requires efforts in a multitude of areas: air and water pollution, water scarcity, sanitation, sustainable transportation, energy, waste disposal, recycling, sustainable production and consumption, decreasing food waste and increasing green areas. This is my ministry's first priority, along with the oceans as the new frontier for the environmental protection and conservation. For this purpose, on March 22nd, we will launch the National Plan to Combat Marine Litter as part of the first National Agenda for Urban Environmental Quality. Aiming at improving the life quality in cities, this plan has the personal support and engagement of our President, Mr. Jair Bolsonaro. Brazil is implementing a national policy for solid waste management since 2010, which is now a priority matter along with the sanitation. The Brazilian government is particularly honored to receive the GCF, the amount of $96 million for successful reducing greenhouse gas emissions from deforestation, which dropped from the 72% from the last 15 years. It's our firm belief that promoting sustainable agriculture is an effective means of preventing illegal deforestation while alleviating poverty and achieving general prosperity. Our energy matrix is renewable, and 33% of biomass has agriculture origin. With only 30% of its territory used for agriculture production, Brazil is the second largest agriculture exporter and feeds around 20% of the world population. Brazil has 64% of its territory protected by law. This makes Brazil the country with the largest protected area in the world. Sustainable tourism must also be expanded through concessions to private companies for public use and national parks. The Brazilian agriculture has shown that it's possible to achieve productiveness gains in full compliance with sustainable development commitments. Brazil does not agree, however, with the alarming tone sometimes used to criticize developing countries' agriculture output. Meeting the requirements for a dignified livelihood for current and future generations, it's not an easy task. Sustainable development requires a delicate balance between environmental, social, economic dimensions. Much still needs to be done, and we all need to rise up to this challenge. Thank you very much.
On remercie Son Excellence Aquilo de Sales pour sa déclaration. J'invite à présent Monsieur le ministre Camille Robinson-Régis de Trinidad et Tobago à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, Monsieur le ministre. Madame le ministre, excusez-moi.
Thank you very kindly, Mr. President. Mr. President, Excellencies, the government and people of the Twin Island Republic of Trinidad and Tobago join with our counterparts in expressing our deepest condolences on the loss of lives that have occurred. Mr. President, coming from the other side of the world, where the threats of rising sea levels, hurricanes and tropical storms, and the warming of the oceans are real and present dangers, our presence in this meeting is undergirded by the Ubuntu philosophy that says, I am because we are. Colleagues, small island developing states such as Trinidad and Tobago are confronted with inherent challenges, and as one of the most industrialized countries in the Caribbean region, Trinidad and Tobago has developed a lifestyle that is heavily interwoven in our oil and gas economy. And although we are slowly transitioning to renewables, a mindset change is an imperative for innovation, not only in the fulfillment of our global obligations, but indeed for our very sustenance. We acknowledge that in order to surmount these systemic and historical challenges, there is need for a paradigm shift, and the components of this shift are contained in our National Development Strategy 2016 to 2030. In furtherance of the objective of this strategy to focus on the preservation and conservation of our environment, we have taken the policy decision to ban the importation of finished expanded polystyrene products for the food and beverage sector, and to remove all duties related to the import of environmentally sensitive and environmentally friendly alternative products. To further incentivize this shift, we have also approved a beverage containers deposit refund policy, which aims to establish an efficient and effective recovery system for recyclables. We contend that this thrust will contribute significantly towards encouraging lifestyle change, promoting alternatives, integrating the informal sector, and to this end, we are working closely with the private sector, NGOs, CBOs, and all citizens towards achieving our goals. Mr. President, this is not all. Tobago boasts the oldest protected forest in the Western Hemisphere, being a protected area since 1776. And in order to ensure that we continue with our reforestation program, we have made it our goal to replant 1 million trees over the next 3 years. There is no better expression of the results of Trinidad and Tobago's ingenuity and propensity for innovation, and may I add, our propensity for creative reuse or recycling than our steel band, which is the only musical instrument invented in the 20th century from discarded oil drums. Mr. President, it is clear that Trinidad and Tobago is
Je remercie Madame le ministre Camille Régis. J'invite à présent Monsieur le ministre Keriako Tobiko, Forêt et Environnement du Kenya, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, Monsieur le ministre.
Excellencies, distinguished delegates, let me join my president in once again extending our warm welcome to all of you, to Kenya and to this beautiful city of Nairobi. Mr. President, according to the IPCC special report on 1.5, warming up to 1.5 is likely to be reached over the next 2 or 3 decades if the world continues with a business as usual approach to greenhouse gases emission. Further, the 2019 Global Chemical Outlook Report, which has been launched here, reports that hazardous chemicals and other pollutants continue to be released in large quantities with accumulation in the environment. Also, the GeoSix, the African edition, reveals that climate change continues to have serious implications on the availability of Africa's arable land and fresh water. Biodiversity loss also poses a major threat to Africa's ecosystems. The members of UNEA 1 in 2014 made critical decisions on how the world can resolve environmental challenges. By the conclusion of this session, member states will have made additional key decisions and adopted various resolutions for implementation. The complete or substantial implementation of the Assembly's resolution, however, remains a challenge that we need to respond to and provide solutions. Otherwise, the economic practice causing global environment challenges will remain intact. Kenya therefore proposes that during this session that we should consider coming up with a mechanism for stock taking, and also, most importantly, for a mechanism for tracking and monitoring the implementation of our resolutions. To enhance the level of implementation of the Assembly's resolution, it is important to also concretize fairness and equity between different states. This includes systems to mobilize adequate financial resources, technology transfer, and capacity building that can support countries that require such support. In order to entrench democracy and human rights, there is need for members to apply public participation in implementation of the Assembly's resolution. The role of civil society, private sector, citizen in engaging with government is also important. In conclusion, Kenya looks forward to collaborating with like-minded partners in working towards the diligent and timeous implementation of the Assembly decisions towards innovation and sustainable production and consumption. I thank you all, and shukran sana.
Je remercie Son Excellence Tobiko pour sa déclaration. J'invite à présent Monsieur Ola Elvestuen, ministre de Norvège, de l'Environnement et du Climat, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, Monsieur le ministre.
President, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. First, Mr. President, my deepest condolences to the Kenyan people, the UN, UN Environment, and all who suffered loss last weekend. It is a terrible tragedy. Many of those on the flight were committed to building a better world. Let us honor them by our actions here at UNEA. Despite that, it is good for me to be here in Nairobi, Kenya, the African seat of the United Nations. Environmental problems do not respect borders. UN Environment has been the midwife for so much international cooperation and many multilateral agreements. Together, we have addressed problems like the ozone hole and dangerous chemical substances. We have developed frameworks to manage biodiversity and climate change. These are threats to all, and particularly the poorest among us. While there are many knowledge gaps, we know enough to act. Just yesterday, the GO6 report was launched, and the message is crystal clear. We cannot afford to sit still. So let's make the decision to take action. And as a consistent partner to the UN, Norway knows that real impact only comes with taking action together. But how can we make the sum of our actions greater than the parts? At UNEA 3, we adopted the Zero Vision, a goal to close the tap of marine litter flowing into our oceans. Waste on land is a huge global issue, but once waste is in the oceans, it is beyond our reach. It does not go away. It is a threat, and it will continue to build up. We cannot be naive about what it will take to really halt the flow of plastics into the oceans and seas. There are immediate actions we can take, but I am convinced we need to be prepared for a long-term solution. So I am here to invite you to a Norwegian dugnad, or as they say in English, many hands make lighter work. Creating an international framework to address marine litter will enable us to achieve more. Together, we took responsibility in Katowice to take our commitments to the Paris Agreement seriously. We adopted the Paris rulebook. Let us now partner so that we in China in 2020 agree on an ambitious global framework for biodiversity. It is time to really join forces and tip the scales in favor of our own future. Thank you.
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre Helvoet Sweene. Pour sa déclaration, j'invite à présent le ministre Kimmo Tiilikainen de Finlande, ministre de l'Environnement, de l'Énergie et du Logement, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, Monsieur le Ministre.
Mr. President, distinguished ministers, ladies and gentlemen, first on behalf of Finnish government, I would like to extend my deepest condolences to all of you who lost someone close to your heart in Sunday's plane accident. Thoughts of all UNEA4 participants are with you. Mr. President, the linear economic model has come to its end. In order to steer our societies to a sustainable path, we need to take giant leaps towards a circular economy. At the same time, we must reduce material consumption and switch from product-based to service-based business models. This is the message from the scientific community. And this is the path member states should walk, because we will not meet the goals of the Paris Agreement and the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development without circular economy. Halting the loss of biodiversity is essential for sustainable development. Unfortunately, we often underestimate the importance of biodiversity, ecosystem services, and nature-based solutions to our well-being, health, and very basic needs such as food and clean water. Circular economy can be part of the solution, and it will help us curb the demand for virgin raw materials and relieve the pressure on natural resources. We need to turn the page and step up our efforts to protect the only planet we have. For Finland, circular economy is a key element in our transition to a carbon neutral and resource-wise society. One important tool in our national transformation has been the circular economy roadmap. It includes more than 60 concrete projects and administrative measures that support circular economy. We have been testing new solutions, particularly for sustainable food systems, timber construction, recycling of municipal waste, and rehabilitation of contaminated land. We also provide incentives for sustainable and innovative public procurement, new product and service innovations, and circular economy investments. Finland is happy to note that circular economy has gained increased attraction in UNEA outcome documents. It has been recognized as an important pathway to more sustainable consumption and production. This is a very important message to many countries around the world that are implementing circular economy policies. To summarize, I believe that we need a revolution in the way we think about the economy. The change in our mindset, together with bold policy measures and innovative businesses, can foster the transition from a fossil pipeline economy to a bio-based circular economy. This transition is something we must and we can do. And we must do that together. Thank you for your attention.
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre Tiilikainen, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent Madame le Ministre Yasmine Fouad, ministre de des Affaires de l'Environnement de l'Égypte, pour faire sa déclaration. Madame la ministre, vous avez la parole.
Thank you. السيد الرئيس، السادة الوزراء ورؤساء الوفود، السيدات والسادة. بداية أتقدم بخالص العزاء لممثلي منظمات الأمم المتحدة وللدول الأعضاء عن وفاة ممثليهم في الحادثة الطائرة الأثيوبية، وقد فقدت مصر 6 من أبنائها. وأود أن أتقدم بخالص التهنئة للسيد رئيس الدورة الحالية على قيادتها الحكيمة للجمعية منذ انتخابه في الدورة الماضية. كما أود أن أتقدم بخالص الشكر والتقدير لحكومة الجمهورية الكينية على حسن الاستضافة وحفاوة الاستقبال، وكذلك حسن التنظيم المتميز لدورتنا الحالية. السيدات والسادة، إن اجتماعنا اليوم يأتي في توقيت بالغ الأهمية على صعيد العمل البيئي متعدد الأطراف، لا سيما في ظل التحديات الجسام التي تواجه جهودنا في سبل تحقيق الاستدامة البيئية. وإنني على ثقة أن المداولات والمناقشات التي سيشهدها اجتماعنا، وكذلك القرارات والإعلانات التي سوف تنتج عنها، ستساهم في تعزيز جهودنا في مواجهة تلك التحديات، وتدعم الدور الذي يقوم به البرنامج الأمم المتحدة للبيئة بوصفه الجهة الرئيسية المعنية بالبيئة في المنظومة الأممية في العمل على إيجاد حلولاً مبتكرة ومستدامة لشتى المشكلات البيئية. يأتي اجتماعنا اليوم في أعقاب عدد من الاجتماعات والمحافل البيئية الهامة، وعلى رأسها مؤتمر الأطراف 24 لاتفاقية الأمم المتحدة الإطارية لتغير المناخ، والذي صدر عنه خطة طموحة لتنفيذ اتفاق باريس. لقد شرفت مصر بتولي مسؤولية رئاسة مجموعة 77 والصين خلال المؤتمر، ولم تدخر جهداً لإنجاح هذا المؤتمر إدراكاً منا لضرورة التواصل إلى توافق يتيح البدء في تنفيذ اتفاق باريس. مع تمسكنا بثوابت المواقف الدول النامية التي حرصنا في الوقت ذاته على مد جسور التواصل مع كل من ممثلي الدول النامية والدول المتقدمة، ونجحنا بالفعل للوصول لذلك التوافق. كما شرفنا أيضاً بتولي مسؤولية رئاسة مجموعة المفاوضين الأفارقة خلال أعمال المؤتمر. وأخيراً، فقد تشرفت شخصياً بتكليفي خلال مؤتمر كاتوفيسكي بالعمل مع زميلي الوزير الدولة الألماني يوخان فلاثبرس لتسوية أحد أهم الموضوعات، وهو المعني بتمويل المناخ، للتوصل إلى صيغة متوازنة وعادلة أرضت جميع الأطراف، بل وأسهمت في حل موضوعات أخرى في المفاوضات. لذلك كله، فإننا في مصر نعتز بإسهامنا في نجاح مؤتمر كاتوفيسكي، والذي ندرك تماماً أنه يتجاوز مجرد اتفاق على برنامج تنفيذ اتفاق باريس ليصبح نجاحاً للعمل متعدد الأطراف، والذي يتعرض لانتقادات وهجمات حادة في الوقت الحالي. السيدات والسادة، لم تقتصر الجهود المصرية في عام 2018 على جانب تغير المناخ، بل استضافت مصر مؤتمر التنوع البيولوجي 14، وصدر عنه عدد من القرارات 73 قرار. وأيضاً أطلقت مصر المبادرة التي تستهدف تحقيق التكامل بين اتفاقيات ريو، تغير المناخ والتنوع البيولوجي ومكافحة التصحر. وإننا سنستكمل هذا المشوار لنصل.
Je remercie Madame le ministre Yasmine Fouad pour sa déclaration. J'invite à présent Monsieur le ministre Sergio Costa de l'Italie à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, Monsieur le ministre.
Thank you in Italian, please. Signor Presidente, signori ministri, signori delegati, inizialmente rivolgo un commosso pensiero alle persone decedute domenica, tra le quali risultano 8 cittadini italiani. E subito desidero affermare che l'Italia è allineata all'Unione Europea e ai suoi Stati membri. Il governo italiano vigorosamente sta lavorando per l'affermazione di un nuovo paradigma dove l'asse produttivo passi dalla logica dell'economia lineare a quella dell'economia circolare e il riuso, il riciclo e il reimpiego di materie prime e seconde siano la parola d'ordine, nel quale il territorio e il mare siano protetti dalle plastiche monouso. Desideriamo costruire una visione nuova e fortemente innovativa di tutela ambientale ed esserne portatori e promotori non solo su scala nazionale, ma su scala mondiale, con atti concreti. Ed è per questo che abbiamo fortemente voluto, con entusiasmo, passione e disponibilità, aprire a Roma, in partnership con la FAO e l'ANDP, il centro di contrasto al cambiamento climatico in atto nel continente africano. Vogliamo cambiare il modo di fare cooperazione sul cambiamento climatico e sulla sostenibilità, ascoltando i bisogni dei paesi beneficiari, discutendo assieme di possibili sviluppi e fornendo loro gli strumenti necessari per raggiungere gli obiettivi prefissati. Al contempo, l'Italia crede molto al sistema mediterraneo e alla tutela e sviluppo e vi annuncio con piacere e con soddisfazione che l'Italia ospiterà nella città di Napoli dal 2 al 5 dicembre 2019 la prossima conferenza delle parti COP21 della Convenzione di Barcellona sulla protezione dell'ambiente marino. Proprio perché questi motivi, crediamo in questi motivi fortemente, noi vogliamo affrontare i rischi legati al cambiamento climatico e offrire la nostra leadership e per questo vincere assieme questa sfida. Pertanto l'Italia si è ufficialmente candidata ad ospitare nel 2020 la COP26. Raccogliendo e facendo nostro il grido di allarme dei giovani del mondo Friday for Future, apprezziamo il lavoro di mediazione fatto per porre l'economia circolare quale elemento essenziale di strategia ambientale, disgiungendo la necessità economica dal degrado ambientale. In questa ottica, però, consideriamo non accettabile la dichiarazione ministeriale a ribasso, specialmente riguardo alle plastiche monouso, per il quale impiego non si rinvengono tempi certi e vincoli determinati, cosa invece fortemente voluta dall'Unione Europea e dall'Italia nello specifico. Avremmo voluto uno scambio di dati ambientali preventivo al fine di costruire insieme un percorso di resilienza ambientale e non intervenire ad evento manifestato. Non guardiamo con favore alla cancellazione di qualsivoglia riferimento alla deforestazione, questione per noi esiziale, di protezione dal climate change e di tutela idrogeologica. Infine, io chiedo a nome del Paese Italia che UNEA 2019 sia ambiziosa e non un'occasione persa, della quale poi pentirsi quando il pianeta si pentirà di noi. Grazie.
Merci à son Excellence, Monsieur le Ministre Sergio Costa. J'invite à présent Madame le Ministre Arlette Soudan Nono, ministre du Tourisme et de l'Environnement du Congo, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, Madame le Ministre.
Excellences, Mesdames et Messieurs, permettez-moi avant tout propos d'adresser mes condoléances les plus émues à la grande famille des Nations Unies ainsi qu'aux parents des victimes du crash du vol d'Ethiopian survenu le dimanche dernier, comme nous l'avons constaté tout le long de notre session, leur absence nous fait cruellement défaut. Excellences, Mesdames et Messieurs, je voudrais tout d'abord, au nom de son Excellence, Denis Sassou Nguesso, président de la République du Congo, chef de l'État, rendre un hommage particulier à son Excellence, Monsieur Uhuru Kenyatta, président de la République du Kenya, à son gouvernement, ainsi qu'à Monsieur Antonio Guterres, secrétaire général des Nations Unies, pour l'énergie et l'efficacité avec lesquelles ils ont préparé et organisé cette importante réunion. Ce devoir accompli, je vous remercie de bien vouloir accueillir le message que je vais vous transmettre au nom du président Denis Sassou Nguesso. Excellences, Mesdames et Messieurs, je souhaite mettre à profit l'occasion solennelle que nous offre cette tribune des Nations Unies pour l'environnement à Nairobi, capitale de la grande nation sœur du Kenya, pour vous parler du pays qui est le mien, la République du Congo. Je vous parle d'un pays situé au cœur du bassin du Congo, deuxième poumon écologique et deuxième réservoir carbone forestier de la planète après l'Amazonie. Je vous parle d'un pays recouvert sur 65% de sa superficie par 23 millions d'hectares de forêt, troisième patrimoine forestier humide du continent africain, et dont le taux de déforestation est de 0,05%, soit l'un des plus faibles au monde. Je vous parle d'un pays où a été récemment mis à jour un véritable trésor écologique, une vaste zone de tourbière située de part et d'autre de notre frontière avec la République démocratique du Congo sœur, gigantesque puits de carbone piégé séquestrant en son sein 30 milliards de tonnes de carbone, soit l'équivalent de 20 années d'émissions des États-Unis d'Amérique et 3 ans de la planète. Je vous parle d'un pays où 17 aires protégées recèlent des joyaux de la biodiversité sur 13% du territoire national et où le cadre légal de protection de l'environnement et que le code forestier sont en pleine rénovation. Je vous parle enfin d'un pays dont la contribution au phénomène du réchauffement climatique global est infinidécimale, mais qui n'en subit pas moins de plein fouet les effets dévastateurs. Érosion au cœur de nos villes, recul du littoral atlantique, pluies diluviennes, inondations, tornades. Excellences, mesdames et messieurs, pleinement conscient des responsabilités qui sont les nôtres, mon gouvernement et moi-même n'avons jamais été dans le déni. Depuis près de 30 ans et sur toutes les tribunes internationales, la République du Congo porte par ma voix sa part d'avertissement face à l'urgence climatique. Excellences, mesdames et messieurs, si nous voulons conjurer le scénario d'un monde où seuls les riches et les puissants profiteront des ultimes ressources au prix d'une aggravation insoutenable des injustices planétaires, l'heure du sursaut est arrivée. Ce n'est pas de votre compassion dont l'Afrique, en général, a besoin, et le Congo en particulier, c'est de votre solidarité. Je vous remercie.
Merci, Madame la ministre Arlette Soudan Nono, pour sa déclaration. J'invite maintenant Madame le ministre Prisca Mfumira du Zimbabwe à faire sa déclaration. Madame le ministre, vous avez la parole.
Mr. Chairman, honorable ministers, excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the government and people of Zimbabwe, I wish to extend my sincere congratulations to the President of UNEA for Mr. Slim V. Kisla for a successful assembly. My delegation congratulates Ms. Inga Anderson on a well-deserved appointment as the new Executive Director of UNEP. We assure you our full support during your term of office. Let me join on behalf of Zimbabwe others in extending our deepest condolences to the UN families, other families, relatives, friends, for those that perished in the Ethiopian airline plane crash of last Sunday morning. Mr. President, there is no doubt that our world is facing a wide range of environmental challenges since the turn of the century. As Zimbabwe, we recognize that these challenges require a paradigm shift in the way we do business. As we may be all aware, the world's poor depend on natural resources for their livelihoods, leading to over-exploitation and hence unsustainable utilization of the same. In order to lessen over-exploitation, it is imperative to intensify agriculture productivity through use of improved and appropriate technologies at every stage of the agricultural value chain. I therefore call upon development partners and other relevant stakeholders to partner Zimbabwe in enhancing sustainable agricultural productivity. In order to embrace life cycle approaches and address one of our key environmental challenges, that is unsustainable solid waste management, the Zimbabwe government declared a one-day per month cleanup program to encourage all citizens to practice sustainable waste management and create a clean, safe, and healthy environment as espoused in our Constitution, Section 73. Ladies and gentlemen, wildlife and forest conservation and protection are also a priority for the government of of Zimbabwe. We believe the sustainable management of these inseparable cultural resources must benefit and improve livelihoods of local communities. In this regard, Zimbabwe has recently reviewed its national forest policy and the world-renowned communal areas management program for indigenous resources, with the triple objectives of increasing community participation, conservation of these resources, and ultimately enhancing benefits that accrue to communities. As a result of sound wildlife and forest management practices, Zimbabwe has enhanced its tourism attractiveness, leading to significant growth in tourist arrivals in the country and being selected as the best sustainable tourism destination this year. Mr. President, as I conclude, let me reiterate Zimbabwe's support for the generation and upscaling of innovative solutions to environmental changes. However, for us to create the future we want without leaving others behind, there must be a balance between innovative solutions to environmental challenges and sustainable consumption and production, as captured in the main theme of UNEA 4 and resolutions thereof. I thank you.
Merci, Madame la Ministre, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent le professeur Fekadou Beyene Aleka, ministre de l'Environnement, des Forêts et du Changement climatique, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, Monsieur le Ministre. L'Éthiopie.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Honorable Ministers, Head of Delegation, Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen. Allow me first, on behalf of the government of Ethiopia, to express my deepest condolences to the families, friends, and colleagues of the victims of the accident on the Ethiopian airline that claimed the lives of our beloved ones on March 10, 2019, while they were en route from Addis Ababa to Nairobi. My prayers are with all families of the victims, member states, and international organizations that have lost their colleagues in this tragic accident. I wish quick recovery for all families and friends of victims and eternal peace for the deceased. Allow me also to express my sincere gratitude to people and the government of the Republic of Kenya for the warm welcome accorded to me and my delegation since our arrival in the evergreen beauty city of Nairobi. I would like also to extend my sincere appreciations to His Excellency, Mr. Sam Valdemar Kessel, Minister of Environment of Estonia, and the current President of the United Nations Environment Assembly for his wonderful leadership. Mr. President, like many other countries in the world, Ethiopia is currently facing pressing environmental challenges related to environmental change, climate change, food security, land degradation, deforestation, biodiversity loss, and pollution, among others. Ethiopia has put in place numerous policies and strategies that are geared towards addressing environmental challenges in the country. Mr. President, Ethiopia is also doing its level best to ensure the conservation of biodiversity and the whole ecosystem. As part of this effort, we have endorsed a new and innovative strategy on payment for ecosystem services to address environmental challenges related to biodiversity loss and ecosystem degradation. Now the process of promulgation of a legal framework for the strategy is being finalized. Furthermore, we are working hard to ensure sound management of waste and chemicals in the country. After the third United Nations Environmental Assembly, Ethiopia has passed a regulation entitled Electrical and Electronic Waste Management and Disposal Regulation, which aims at addressing pollution from electrical and electronic waste. Additionally, the government of Ethiopia passed a regulation to limit the total concentration of lead in paints or any other products to 90 parts per million. The adoption of this proclamation by the parliament clearly shows the commitment of Ethiopia to address pollution challenges and implementation of the UNEA 3 resolution and declarations. These achievements demonstrate the effective and exemplary collaboration between the government, development partners, and the civic society. Mr. President, I firmly believe that innovative solutions as defined as business as unusual approach are the viable and presumably the only way to address daunting environmental challenges. This in turn necessitates collective actions at national, regional, and international levels, as well as effective means of implementation if addressing in addressing our environmental challenges via innovative solutions is sought. Hence, Ethiopia calls for international cooperation and assistance to address environmental challenges in innovation and sustainable way. In conclusion, Ethiopia wishes to reiterate its unwavering commitment to work with all concerned actors to address our planet's environmental challenges as well as to achieve sustainable development. I thank you, Mr. President. Asante sana.
Merci, Professeur Fekadou, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent Monsieur le ministre Tokelina Finikasso, ministre des Affaires étrangères, du Commerce et du Tourisme de Tuvalu. Monsieur le ministre, vous avez la parole.
Mr. President, Excellencies and colleagues, please allow me to convey the government and the people of Tuvalu's most heartfelt and deepest sympathies to our UN family, especially to those countries and families who have lost their loved one in the recent tragedy. Mr. President, Tuvalu expresses appreciation for the invitation to engage in meaningful dialogue for the sustainable management of our environment and natural resources with a very challenging theme. Like many of us from the Pacific Ocean coastal state, the sea is the basis of our livelihood. Our economic development, culture, traditions, and spiritual values are intrinsically attached to the ocean and the effective management of our marine resources. Marine debris, especially plastics and many others, are decimating reefs and marine life. These environmental hazards are increasing the vulnerability of coastal and small island developing states. Mr. President, we gather here to call for the prevention and reduction of human-induced marine pollution and the establishment of a coordinated global governance mechanism to address the negative impacts of marine litter, including plastic litter and microplastic. We call for ongoing commitments under UNCLOS and SDG 14 and agency actions to address this issue with concrete solutions. The threat from climate change is real. Addressing the impacts of climate change is a top priority for Tuvalu's National Strategy for Development, Sustainable Development. We are committed to achieving 100% renewable energy of power generation by 2025, and we have achieved 35% reduction through solar energy. This is our NDC under the Paris Agreement. We have ratified the Kigali Amendment to the Montreal Protocol to phase down the use of HFCs to keep average global temperature well below the 1.5 degrees Celsius. We are committed to establishing 10% of our EEZ as marine protected areas. We are currently conserving 18% of our terrestrial area, which surpasses the IT biodiversity target. We are committed to the protection of biodiversity and traditional knowledge. This was strengthened through our accession to the Nagoya Protocol in 2018. We have established our integrated waste policy and action plan, which supports the objectives of the SDGs and Cleaner Pacific 2025, a regional strategy to address the management of waste pollution. The government is developing new legislation to ban plastics in Tuvalu, starting by hosting a plastic-free 2019 Pacific Island Leaders Forum. Tuvalu is establishing a Pacific Islands Climate Change Insurance Facility with technical support from the UN nation. This initiative is to help Pacific Island countries rebuild during and after the impact of climate change-induced disaster. Tuvalu is also sponsoring a draft UNGA resolution in the upcoming meeting in September. We aim to protect the rights of people displaced by climate change. I seek the support of UN Environment and members of this two-initiative. Last but not the least, I wish to convey a sincere gratitude to the government and people of Kenya for the hospitality and for hosting such an important conference. I also wish to recognize UNEF for its expertise and efficient arrangements for the Assembly. I thank you, Mr. President.
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent Monsieur le Ministre Socrates Famelos, ministre de l'Environnement et de l'Énergie de la Grèce, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, Monsieur le Ministre.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. President, UNEA 4 offers us an excellent opportunity to discuss and exchange practical approaches and innovative solutions on how to address unsustainable patterns, production and consumption patterns, which is one of the most cross-sectoral challenges we have to face. Economic growth should not be considered as an enemy of ecology and environment. There are ways to achieve prosperity in a sustainable manner. The connection of employment and economy with environment and ecology is the only way for our future. Environmental degradation and the sustainable research management is not politically neutral. It has a strong political aspect, since natural resources that belong to everybody are exploited at the expense of society. It is connected with a lack of social justice and the redistribution of wealth at the expense of the poorer citizens. In Greece, as it refers to the ecological footprint, we exceed the sustainability limit, the carrying capacity, less than the other developed countries. But there is a long way ahead of us to reach sustainability limits. We need to shift towards a low-carbon circular economy model with more integrated life cycle approaches that help create new business through service provision for repairing products, remove barriers from the use of secondary raw materials, as well as support the integration of recycled materials, promoting resource efficiency with less chemicals inputs, less and cleaner energy, and less waste outputs. But most of all, we need political decision at the highest level. We need a universal alliance. For Greece, this is the part of our growth strategy. We have developed an energy climate national plan for 2030, as well as a national strategy on circular economy, where there is a detailed action plan with short-term and medium-term actions that include, among others, increased recycling through ambitious targets and the improvement of the operational rules for extended producer responsibility schemes to fully internalize the waste management cost of certain products, application of the pay-as-you-throw principle for municipalities, the circular economy tax to avoid landfill disposal, measures to reduce the consumption, removal of administrative barriers for secondary materials, promotion of industrial symbiosis, support of reuse, and promotion of biogas and green gas. Our mix of measures in Greece also include incentives through taxation, like car taxation proportional for CO2 emission, and pricing, with environmental fee set on single-use plastic bags, resulting to a drastic reduction of their use, while generating important revenues going back to promote reuse and recycling at local level. Furthermore, environmental sustainability considerations should be a key investment criteria for public expenditure and for the selection of private projects for the banking sector. Ladies and gentlemen, cooperation on environmental issues can be a catalyst for peace and stability at regional level. Following the reference made by my Italian colleague earlier, let me also stress the importance of the upcoming COP21 of the Barcelona Convention in Naples in December, as it will provide us with the opportunity to discuss key emerging issues and sectors pertaining to the environment and sustainable development in the Mediterranean in the years to come. In this direction, we implement already other trilateral initiatives with Cyprus, Israel and Egypt in East Mediterranean, connecting environment and pollution control with peace, stability and friendship. Thank you very much.
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre, pour votre déclaration. Je vais inviter à présent Madame le Secrétaire d'État, Madame Neza El Aouafi, Secrétaire d'État du Développement durable du Maroc. Vous avez la parole, Madame le Secrétaire d'État.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم السيد الرئيس السيدات والسادة الوزراء اسمحوا لي في البداية باسم المملكة المغربية أن أتقدم بتعازي الحارة للأمم المتحدة ولأسر ضحايا فاجعة الطائرة الإثيوبية كما أود أن أغتنم هذه الفرصة لتقديم الشكر الجزيل للحكومة وللشعب الكيني على حفاوة الاستقبال ولبرنامج الأمم المتحدة للبيئة على كل المجهودات المبذولة لإنجاح هذا اللقاء حضرات السيدات والسادة الزملاء المحترمين كما تعلمون أن ضخامة التحديات التي نواجهها اليوم تفرض علينا التفكير جديا في النموذج الاقتصادي الحالي المبني على تصور خطي ينهك الموارد الطبيعية من جهة وينتج النفايات والتلوث بصورة مكثفة من جهة أخرى مما يحتم الانخراط الفعلي المستعجل في مشروع تنمية اقتصادية تأخذ بعين الاعتبار الاستغلال معقلا للبيئة وحماية الأوساط الطبيعية ومن أجل مواجهة هذه التحديات ووعيا منه بالدور الذي يجب أن يلعبه المغرب للمساهمة في الأجندة البيئية والمناخية العالمية قام قامت المملكة المغربية بوضع مجموعة من الإصلاحات على المستوى القانوني والمؤسساتي والعملي، وتعزز هذا المسار باعتماد الاستراتيجية الوطنية للتنمية المستدامة تحت الرئاسة الفعلية في مجلس وزاري لصاحب الجلالة الملك محمد السادس نصره الله. وقد جعلت هذه الاستراتيجية التي تطمح إلى تحقيق الانتقال نحو اقتصاد أخضر مندمج في أفق 2030 من الاقتصاد الدائري ومن الانتاج والاستهلاك المستدام أحد أوراقها. وفي هذا الإطار قام المغرب بوضع مخطط عمل وطني حول طرق الإنتاج والاستهلاك المستدام، ومن أجل تدبير مستدام للنفايات قمنا مؤخراً ولأول مرة بتقديم استراتيجية وطنية لتقليص وتثمين النفايات، مع وضع برنامج طموح لتطوير منظومات التدوير بهدف تقليص التلوث الناتج عن النفايات ومنح فرص مهمة للاستثمار وخلق فرص الشغل، مما سينخرط فيه المغرب نحو اقتصاد أخضر بنجاعة وفعالية. وتعزز الورش مكافحة التلوث البيئي بالمغرب باعتماد برنامج وطني للتطهير السائل في العالم القروي سنة 2019 وفي المجال الطاقي. وبفضل التوجهات الملكية السامية حقق المغرب نتائج مهمة فيما يخص تطوير الطاقات المتجددة، التي نهدف للوصول إلى 52% في أفق 2030 من القدرة الكهربائية المحدثة. ومن جهة أخرى، ولجعل القطاع العام محفزا للانتقال نحو أنماط إنتاج واستهلاك مستدام، تم اعتماد ميثاق مثالية الدولة الذي يلزم المؤسسات باعتماد مقاربات وممارسة مسؤولة بيئيا واعتماد النقل المستدام الأخضر واعتماد سياسة صناعة عمومية مستدامة وتدبير معقل للموارد. إن مواجهة التحديات المرتبطة بالانتقال نحو أنماط الإنتاج والاستهلاك يفرض علينا ضرورة الأخذ بعين الاعتبار حاجيات بلدان إفريقيا فيما يتعلق الدعم التقني وتقوية القدرات والدعم المالي. إن المغرب سيداتي سادتي لن يدخر جهدا للإسهام في تسريع وتيرة الانتقال الإيكولوجي. وفي هذا الإطار سيتشرف المغرب خلال الشهر القادم باحتضان الدورة الخامسة للمنتدى الإفريقي للتنمية المستدامة، وسنظل ملتزمين من أجل انخراط واستشراف جماعي لربح رهان التنمية المستدامة بالعالم. شكرا لكم.
Merci madame le secrétaire d'État pour votre déclaration. Nous allons à présent inviter monsieur le ministre João Fernandes, ministre de l'Environnement et de la Transition énergétique du Portugal, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, monsieur le ministre.
Mr. President, Your Excellencies, I would start by expressing my sincere condolences to the families and loved ones of all the victims of the plane crash last Sunday. Allow me to congratulate the Estonian Presidency of the fourth session of the United Nations Environmental Assembly for organizing this session and giving us the opportunity to deepen our reflection on innovative solutions for environmental challenges and sustainable consumption and production. This theme reminds us of the commitments that we need to make to reshape our economy towards a circular economy and to urgently fight climate change, complying with the Paris Agreement. Portugal believes that addressing climate change challenges and promoting the transition towards a low-carbon society will allow us to be more prosperous, to create more jobs, to have a fair society well within the limits imposed by our natural system. Furthermore, it represents investment opportunities for our countries and cities. The Portuguese environmental policy designed for the next years is set in three connected goals: decarbonizing society and promoting the energy transition, valuing the territory, and move towards a more circular economy. First, decarbonizing. In 2016, and in line with the ambition of the Paris Agreement, Portugal was the first country in the world to set the goal of being carbon neutral in 2050. Our path towards neutrality is defined on the Carbon Neutrality Roadmap and in our National Energy and Climate Plan, which establish our climate and energy national targets, so that by 2030, we intend to reduce between 45 and 55% the greenhouse gas emissions in relation to 2005. We have set a target of 35% for energy efficiency, we want to achieve 47% of renewable in gross final energy demand, and 80% of the electricity produced in Portugal will come from endogenous renewable sources. Portugal is a leader in the following fields. We have reduced greenhouse gas emissions in 22% since 2005. We have decreased our energy consumption, and in March 2018, renewable energy delivered more than 100% of Portugal electricity consumption for the first time. Second, promoting circular economy. There can be no carbon neutral economy without a circular economy, one that preserves resources inside our economic system, extracting value in a slower, more productive way. An economy that promotes sharing, the design for reuse, for repair, for remanufacture, one in which I pay for the service the product gives me, not the product itself, an economy that preserves rather than destroys. Third, value the territory. To be carbon neutral does not mean zero emissions. It means that we need to adapt our territory and we need to have a thriving, sustainable and resilient forests. This is why it is very disappointing to know that in this in year four, we did not reach a consensus in the resolution to combat deforestation. To conclude, the environmental tasks in the actual economy model are challenging, but we believe that with innovative solutions for environment, we can think beyond and live within towards a better and sustainable world. Thank you.
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre João, pour votre déclaration. Nous invitons maintenant à prendre la parole Madame le Ministre Marie-Christine Marguem, ministre de l'Énergie, de l'Environnement et du Développement durable de la Belgique. Vous avez la parole, Madame le Ministre.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Monsieur le Président, Excellences, Mesdames, Messieurs, les évaluations scientifiques, nous le savons, sont claires. Elle nous apporte la confirmation de la nécessité d'une action urgente et internationale. En ce moment même, des milliers de jeunes manifestent chaque semaine, chaque jeudi plus précisément, dans mon pays et dans d'autres pays également, pour plus d'ambition sur les enjeux du climat. Ces jeunes, je les ai rencontrés à plusieurs reprises et j'ai senti chez eux une véritable angoisse. C'est à nous qu'il convient de trouver des réponses à cette angoisse. Ce mouvement nourrit ma détermination à poursuivre le travail avec les ministres des régions de la Belgique, avec vous tous, pour concrétiser la transition énergétique dans notre pays et dans le monde. Une transition vers une économie sobre en carbone, neutre pour le climat et efficace dans l'utilisation des ressources demande une approche holistique. Elle ne se réalise pas en traitant des défis en silos, en vases séparés les uns des autres. Il faut mettre la science, la technologie et l'innovation au service de cette transition. Je remercie donc UN Environment d'avoir choisi ce sujet comme thème principal pour notre quatrième session. Monsieur le Président, Excellences, Mesdames, Messieurs, la Belgique, dans toutes ses composantes, est prête à jouer son rôle et à montrer l'exemple. Permettez-moi de me focaliser sur deux exemples concrets, l'économie circulaire et la biodiversité océanique. Tant dans le domaine du tri des déchets que le recyclage des matières premières, la Belgique se situe au premier plan européen et mondial. J'ai pourtant décidé d'aller plus loin encore en finançant une série d'études afin d'identifier les freins à la recyclabilité par catégorie de déchets. Le résultat de ce travail se poursuivra bien après cette législature, car je suis convaincue que la préservation de l'environnement s'inscrit sur le très long terme. Le mois dernier, nous avons accueilli la conférence du Forum mondial des ressources qui portait sur de nombreuses initiatives prometteuses afin de les rendre économiquement viables. La lutte contre les pertes et gaspillages alimentaires est un autre domaine auquel nous sommes attentifs également en Belgique. Et par le biais des Green Deals volontaires, la Belgique, par exemple, favorise et stimule l'engagement des partenaires privés dans des domaines comme la politique d'achat circulaire, la mobilité partagée, la logistique durable au sein des villes, le bâtiment circulaire et la promotion d'une alimentation plus durable. L'année passée, pas moins de 4,5 milliards d'euros ont été levés avec ces obligations. Au cours de cette Assemblée, l'Union européenne a tenté de faire progresser l'action commune visant à lutter contre la déforestation en tenant compte de la chaîne d'approvisionnement des produits de base agricoles. Je remercie les nombreux pays ici présents qui ont soutenu cette initiative qui, malheureusement, n'a pu aboutir. Et je m'engage avec eux à poursuivre un dialogue ambitieux sur cette question. Monsieur le Président, Excellences, je terminerai avec la biodiversité océanique qui est mise à rude épreuve à cause notamment des changements climatiques, de la pollution, de la perte d'habitat côtier et de la surexploitation des espèces marines. Nous devons agir. Le mois passé, la Belgique a organisé une conférence internationale, Monsieur le Président, à laquelle vous avez participé, sur les conséquences du changement climatique sur les océans. Une déclaration, intitulée « Déclaration de Bruxelles », en est l'aboutissement. Elle est signée par 30 pays et elle souligne l'importance de la recherche scientifique, appelant entre autres à réduire les émissions du transport maritime. Je saisis cette occasion pour inviter les autres pays.
Ça ira. On vous remercie, Madame le Ministre, une femme très engagée pour la lutte contre le changement climatique et la préservation des océans. Je vous prie d'applaudir, Madame le Ministre Mergam. J'invite à présent Monsieur le Ministre Dimitri Kobylkin, ministre des Ressources naturelles et de l'Environnement de la Fédération de Russie, à faire sa déclaration. Monsieur le ministre, vous avez la parole.
Thank you very much. Уважаемый господин председатель, уважаемые участники, Россия также присоединяется к соболезнованиям всем родным и близким, погибшим в авиакатастрофе в Кении. Основной темой Ассамблеи являются инновационные решения для смягчения экологических проблем и устойчивое производство и потребление. Экология вошла в число приоритетных и стратегических направлений развития Российской Федерации до 2024 года, определенных в указе президента России Владимира Владимировича Путина. Для практической реализации мы разработали национальный проект «Экология». Приоритетными направлениями стали управление отходами производства и потребления, значительное снижение уровня загрязнения атмосферного воздуха в крупнейших промышленных центрах страны, повышение качества питьевой воды, экологическое оздоровление водных объектов и сохранение биоразнообразия. Решение важнейших задач требует самого серьезного и комплексного подхода. Считаем, что здесь заложены принципы циркулярной экономики, основы четвертой промышленной революции, как было заявлено на Международном экономическом форуме в Давосе в 2016 году. Линейные модели производства, доставшиеся нам в наследство, сегодня обнаруживают все больше серьезных недостатков, одним из которых являются растущие экологические проблемы. Циркулярная экономика предполагает непрерывный оборот технических и биологических материалов при производстве и сохранении ценных природных ресурсов. Но есть, то есть устойчивое производство и потребление. Бесполезный мусор для одной компании может оказаться ценным сырьем для другой. Пар, вода, шлак, песок, биоотходы. Уже сейчас эти материалы идут в дело при налаженном обмене. Считаем, что циркулярность экономики является важнейшим свойством зеленой устойчивой экономики. На повестке дня стоит гораздо больше, чем просто вопросы об отношениях природных ресурсов и климатических изменений. Речь также идет об экономическом росте и создании новых рабочих мест, о путях дальнейшего развития всего мира. Россия предпринимает системные меры на пути внедрения модели экономического замкнутого цикла. Кроме работы на национальном уровне, мы, безусловно, будем укреплять международное сотрудничество, изучая наилучший зарубежный опыт. Уверен, развитие международного диалога и доверительных партнерских отношений будут способствовать повышению общемировой эффективности для экономики будущего. Насколько далекого будущего, полностью зависит от нас. Спасибо за внимание.
Merci, monsieur le ministre Dimitri, pour votre déclaration. J'invite maintenant le ministre Moussa Mohamed Ahmed, ministre de l'Habitat, de l'Environnement, de l'urbanisme de Djibouti, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, monsieur le ministre.
Merci, monsieur le président. Monsieur le président, mesdames et messieurs, il m'est particulièrement agréable
d'être parmi vous pour prendre la parole à l'occasion de la quatrième session de l'Assemblée générale des Nations unies pour l'environnement. Le thème retenu pour cette session s'intitule « Solutions innovantes pour faire face aux défis environnementaux et pour favoriser des productions et des consommations durables ». Ce thème nous incite à promouvoir des actions concrètes allant dans le sens de la préservation et de la protection de notre planète. Les premiers défis auxquels notre planète est confrontée aujourd'hui, c'est le changement climatique. En effet, le changement climatique est devenu une menace grave et grandissante. Les ouragans, le sécheresse, le feu des forêts, la fonte des glaciers, les précipitations diluviennes, les inondations violentes sont autant d'éléments témoignant des impacts des dérèglements climatiques sur notre planète. Le pays en développement, notamment la République de Djibouti, est vulnérable aux conséquences dramatiques du changement climatique. Nous ressentons déjà les impacts du changement climatique qui affectent durement nos populations, nos écosystèmes. La République de Djibouti est frappée régulièrement par le sécheresse qui impacte fortement les populations rurales. Notre pays est par ailleurs soumis à un stress hydrique de plus en plus aigu. Pour faire face aux défis du changement climatique, le gouvernement de Djibouti, avec l'appui des partenaires au développement, a entrepris des actions d'adaptation au changement climatique dont l'objectif est d'augmenter la résilience des populations vulnérables, des écosystèmes fragiles et des infrastructures essentielles. En matière d'atténuation de la République de Djibouti, fort de son potentiel en énergie renouvelable, s'est engagé dans une politique sombre en carbone visant à mettre en place des programmes d'énergie solaire, éolien, géothermique au niveau national. Le deuxième défi auquel le monde est confronté, c'est celui de la perte de biodiversité. L'Afrique regorge d'une biodiversité essentielle qui commence à se raréfier à cause de la sécheresse, des actions anthropiques et des changements climatiques. La biodiversité fournit des services écosystémiques importants pour l'homme. La biodiversité contribue également au développement économique de nos pays, puisque le développement du tourisme et de pêche est basé sur les écosystèmes terrestres et marins qu'il est indispensable pour préserver si l'on veut atteindre un développement durable. Le troisième défi auquel l'humanité est confrontée, c'est celui de la pollution de l'air, de l'eau, des sols. Permettez-moi d'insister ici sur la pollution par le plastique qui affecte maintenant tous les océans de la planète, menaçant des écosystèmes marins qui sont indispensables pour le développement de la pêche et du tourisme. Je vous remercie pour votre attention.
Merci, Monsieur le ministre Moussa, pour vos déclarations. J'invite à présent Monsieur le ministre Adala Attira, ministre de l'Autorité de la Qualité de l'Environnement de l'État de Palestine. Vous avez la parole, Madame le ministre.
Shukran, Sayyid al-Ra'is. أصحاب المعالي والعطوفة سيدات والسادة الحضور الكريم كلهم باسمه ولقبه السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته بداية نعزي أنفسنا وذوي الضحايا بسبب تحطم الطائرة الأثيوبية ونقول رحمهم الله من ناحية أخرى اسمحوا لي أن أتقدم بالشكر والتقدير لدولة كينيا حكومة وشعبا على حسن الضيافة والاستقبال وأن أتقدم بالتهاني لسيدة أندرسون بمناسبة اختيارها لتسلم المنصب الجديد اللي هي المدير التنفيذي لبرنامج أمم متحدة للبيئة نتمنى لها التقدم والنجاح اسمحوا لي أيضا أن أنقل لكم تحيات فخامة الرئيس محمود عباس رئيس دولة فلسطين وتحيات حكومة وشعب فلسطين الذي يتطلع إلى نيل الحرية وإقامة دولته المستقلة وعاصمتها القدس الشريف عاصمة البيئة العربية لعام 2019 والتي تتعرض لتشويه متعمد من قبل الاحتلال الإسرائيلي لموروثها التاريخي والديني والثقافي والطبيعي السيدات والسادة يأتي انعقاد هذه الدورة لجمعية الأمم المتحدة تحت عنوان حلول مبتكرة للتحديات البيئية والإنتاج والاستهلاك المستدامين كإقرار من المجتمع الدولي على أهمية تحقيق التنمية المستدامة من أجل الأجيال الحاضر والمستقبل وإننا في دولة فلسطين إذ نشارك المجتمع الدولي في هذا الجهد ونسعى إلى إنجاح هذا التوجه الذي يخدم البشرية جمعاء وهذا يتطلب منا حماية العمل متعدد الأطراف وصونه كإطار جامع للدول لإيجاد الحلول للمشاكل التي تواجه البشرية ومنع التنمر الذي يتعرض له هذا النظام والذي يهدف إلى تقويده السيدات والسادة تواجه دولة فلسطين تحدي فريد ومن نوع آخر للنهوض بمسؤوليتها تجاه حماية البيئة بسبب الاحتلال الذي لا يتوانى عن انتهاج وتبني سياسات وممارسات تستهدف وجودنا وتستغل مواردنا الطبيعية مخالفاً بذلك كل المواثيق والأعراف الدولية وإحدى ضحايا هذه الممارسات غير القانونية هي البيئة بكل مكوناتها حيث يحظر الاحتلال على فلسطين استخدام ما لا يقل عن 62% من أراضي دولة فلسطين في الضفة الغربية بما يشمل القدس الشرقية ويقوم باستغلالها لتنفيذ مشروعه الاستعماري والتوسعي لإقامة مستوطناته غير الشرعية وأيضاً بنائه لجدار الضم والتوسع وإغلاق مساحات واسعة من الأراضي الفلسطينية الخصبة واستخدامها لأغراض التدريب العسكري أو كمكب لنفاياته الخطرة والسامة هذا الأمر أثبتته عدة تقارير ذات مصداقية حيث تم رصد 98 موقعاً للتخلص من النفايات الإسرائيلية في أرضنا الفلسطينية بما يحدث خللاً خطيراً للنظم الإيكولوجية والتوازن البيئي كما أن الحصار البري والبحري الذي يفرضه الاحتلال على قطاع غزة والاعتداءات العسكرية المتكررة كل ذلك يشكل انتهاكاً جسيماً لمبادئ القانون الدولي ذات الصلة بحماية البيئة في مناطق النزاع السيدات والسادة بالرغم من كل ما سبق من تحديات فإننا مصممون على المضي قدماً في صوم وحماية البيئة في فلسطين من خلال الانضمام للأطر والقوانين الدولية ذات الصلة لقد اعتمدت الحكومة الفلسطينية أجندة السياسات الوطنية لعام 17-22 والتي تعتبر إطاراً توجيهياً شاملاً للتنمية المستدامة ولإدماج البعد البيئي والتغير المناخي في مختلف البرامج والسياسات وخطط
Merci madame le ministre Adala pour votre contribution. J'invite à présent monsieur le ministre Gwamundur Ngio Goranson, excusez-moi, ministre de l'Environnement et des Ressources naturelles de l'Islande. Vous avez la parole, monsieur le ministre.
President, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen. When was the first time you realized that if you buy 3 bags of groceries, you really leave one behind in the store, because globally we waste roughly 1/3 of our food? When was the first time you realized that much of the groceries you bought are not only wrapped in plastics, detrimental to the health of our oceans, but also that your juicy shrimp sandwich, for example, may indeed be filled with plastics? Our unsustainable consumption has gone out of hand, with dire effects on the environment and the climate. The good news, however, is that we have opportunities and we have solutions. Let's not forget that there is value in our waste, there is value in our sludge, and there is much benefit in knowledge and innovation to use these value streams in a circular economy fashion. The draft ministerial declaration here at the UN Environment Assembly points to many of the efforts we need to undertake in the coming years, and Iceland supports them fully. In 2020, the international community will decide on new biodiversity targets for 2030. Habitat protection, invasive alien species, and restoration of degraded forests, wetlands, and other important ecosystems should be high on the agenda, and synergies with other environmental problems. Such synergetic approaches have been emphasized by the Icelandic government through our new climate action plan. One of its pillars is restoration of woodlands and wetlands, combating desertification and climate change, at the same time as regaining biodiversity. The Icelandic government is committed to nature conservation and now prepares for the establishment of a large national park in the central highland of the country, a vast wilderness area covering between 30% to 40% of the total area of Iceland, that will by far be the largest national park in Europe. Tackling the plastic issue is high on the agenda in Iceland, and under our upcoming chairmanship at the Arctic Council, Iceland will put emphasis on fighting plastic pollution. Iceland strongly supports a global action on fighting the plastic problem and therefore supports the resolution on plastic pollution here at UNEA to mandate a process where we can discuss a strengthened global governance on marine litter and microplastics, something that can hopefully develop into a legally binding framework on the issue in the future. Dear friends, let's stop leaving that one bag of three behind in the grocery store. And let's stop that bag and its contents being made from single-use plastics. The time to preserve our planet is now. Thank you.
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent Monsieur le Ministre Hamedi Camara, ministre de l'Environnement et du Développement Durable de Mauritanie, à faire sa déclaration. Monsieur le Ministre, vous avez la parole.
Excellences, Mesdames et Messieurs les Ministres, Mesdames et Messieurs les Ambassadeurs et chefs de délégation, Mesdames et Messieurs les participants, suite à l'accident tragique du vol éthiopien d'Airlines survenu le 10 mars 2019, permettez-moi tout d'abord d'adresser mes vives condoléances à l'ensemble des familles des personnes disparues. Je profite de la tenue de la 4e session de l'UNEA pour féliciter son Excellence M. Siim Kiisler, ministre de l'Environnement de la République d'Estonie, pour la confiance qui lui a été accordée en qualité de président de la 4e session de l'UNEA. Mes félicitations vont également à l'ensemble des membres du bureau de l'Assemblée. Qu'ils soient assurés de notre appui et de notre encouragement, notre présente Assemblée m'offre aussi l'opportunité de féliciter Mme Inger Andersson, nouvelle directrice exécutive de l'ONU Environnement, pour sa nomination et la confiance qui lui a été accordée en sa qualité de directrice exécutive de l'ONU Environnement. Son expérience et son leadership reconnu lui permettront sans doute d'assurer le rayonnement de l'ONU Environnement et l'atteinte de ses objectifs. Aussi, j'exprime ma satisfaction pour avoir eu l'occasion de prendre part aux travaux de cette importante Assemblée et vous exprime l'engagement de mon pays pour assurer un niveau élevé de mise en œuvre des orientations de l'UNEA. Notre présence tous ici témoigne de l'intérêt que manifeste la communauté internationale tout entière aux politiques environnementales et au renforcement de la gouvernance environnementale au niveau régional, national et local. Les temps portant sur les solutions innovantes pour relever les défis environnementaux et pour une consommation et une production durable qui est retenue pour cette Assemblée, ainsi que la teneur et la consistance de la déclaration ministérielle, témoignent d'un niveau remarquable de prise de conscience, de synergie, d'anticipation et de modélisation. Mon pays, la République islamique de Mauritanie, suit avec un grand intérêt les processus ambitieux et réussis de réformes économiques et démocratiques amorcées ces dernières années sous la présidence de son Excellence, M. Mohamed Abdelaziz, président de la République. Ces réformes se sont traduites, entre autres, acquis par une inscription en France dans les logiques du développement durable à travers une approche stratégique de lutte contre la pauvreté, intégrant à la fois les dimensions sociales, économiques et environnementales. Toutefois, le profil environnemental de mon pays nous met en face d'un certain nombre de défis écologiques permanents. Parmi ces défis, on peut citer les sécheresses récurrentes, les inondations, l'érosion côtière, la perte de la biodiversité, la dégradation et la salinisation des sols, et d'autres préjudices écologiques fortement ressentis par nos populations rurales. Nous sommes conscients que si les mesures de réponse appropriées ne sont pas prises, nos populations et nos économies seront fortement menacées. La Mauritanie étant un pays fortement sensible aux conséquences des changements climatiques, elle est connue pour être un des pays africains les plus impactés dans le monde, avec notamment l'augmentation déjà critique de la fréquence et de l'intensité des phénomènes météorologiques extrêmes. Certaines régions du pays subissent d'ores et déjà un stress hydrique de plus en plus problématique, remettant en cause les équilibres écosystémiques. Face à cette situation, notre pays a entrepris la mise en œuvre d'une nouvelle stratégie nationale de développement durable qui représente un cadre logique qui met en cohérence les synergies entre les programmes et les plans politiques sectoriels dans une perspective de durabilité et dans l'esprit de préparation, de participation de tous, de tous les acteurs. Excellences, Mesdames et Messieurs, dans ce contexte, la Mauritanie s'est attelée à mettre en place des mesures de réponse appropriées, aussi bien sur le plan opérationnel, stratégique que politique. En matière juridique et législation, nous avons ratifié et signé beaucoup de, pratiquement la plupart des conventions internationales. En matière de politique, de stratégie et de plan d'action, dans ce domaine, la Mauritanie, conformément à ses engagements à travers les accords multilatéraux et bilatéraux et lors de sa participation aux différentes conférences et sommets mondiaux, a élaboré et adopté plusieurs politiques stratégiques et plans d'action et leur mise en œuvre.
Merci, Monsieur le ministre Camara, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent le secrétaire d'État Hugo Morán de l'Environnement et des Affaires Rurales de l'Espagne à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, Monsieur le secrétaire d'État.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Me sumo a las condolencias a las familias de los fallecidos en el trágico accidente aéreo, dos de las víctimas nacionales españoles. Señores delegados, señoras delegadas, la comunidad internacional se enfrenta a grandes retos ambientales que presentan vínculos evidentes entre sí. Los impactos del cambio climático ponen en peligro la biodiversidad, acentúan el riesgo de desertificación e incrementan los problemas de salud. La contaminación ambiental de todo tipo, que incide también en salud y biodiversidad, a menudo proviene de actividades asimismo responsables del cambio climático. Retos, como vemos, profundamente interrelacionados a los que solo podemos hacer frente con un cambio de paradigma, una revisión del modo en que producimos y consumimos. Hemos dado pasos importantes pero insuficientes. El Acuerdo de París constituyó un hito, pero sabemos que hemos de elevar la ambición para lograr sus objetivos. Los esfuerzos emprendidos en materia de biodiversidad son, sin duda, loables, pero en la reciente COP de Egipto comprobamos que, pese a éxitos parciales, la pérdida de biodiversidad continúa acentuándose. Cada vez apreciamos mayor preocupación por la salud de nuestros océanos, pero su situación sigue empeorando. Debemos poner en práctica soluciones innovadoras, tecnológicas y socioeconómicas para proteger nuestro entorno y orientar nuestras sociedades hacia modelos de producción y consumo más sostenibles dentro de los límites del planeta, en línea con los Objetivos de Desarrollo Sostenible de Naciones Unidas y desacoplar el desarrollo económico de los impactos ambientales. España está dando pasos en esa dirección. Acabamos de elaborar un Plan Nacional Integrado de Energía y Clima que nos exige reducir un tercio de nuestras emisiones de gases de efecto invernadero antes de 2030. Estamos elaborando una estrategia de economía circular a 2030 con el objetivo de mejorar la productividad de los materiales en un 30% respecto al 2015. Y hemos multiplicado nuestras áreas marinas protegidas creando un corredor de migración de cetáceos en el Mediterráneo y un gran parque nacional marino en Baleares, superando ya el 12% de superficie marina protegida. Las metas están claras y enfoques innovadores que ayuden a alcanzarlas son imprescindibles. Pero hemos de hacer un esfuerzo que va mucho más allá de lo que hemos venido haciendo hasta ahora. Un esfuerzo que exige transformar en la próxima década el modo en que nos relacionamos con nuestro entorno. Y hay que hacerlo rápido. La ventana de oportunidad para revertir la situación se está cerrando y no disponemos de mucho tiempo. Si queremos salvar a la humanidad, hemos de preservar la biodiversidad. Así que, señoras y señores, manos a la obra. Muchas gracias.
Merci, Monsieur le secrétaire d'État Hugo Morán, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent Monsieur le secrétaire d'État Jochen Flash Barth de l'Environnement et de la Conservation de la Nature et de la Sécurité nucléaire de l'Allemagne. Monsieur le secrétaire d'État, vous avez la parole.
Thank you, Chair, ladies and gentlemen, colleagues and friends. The global economic system is increasingly reaching its limits. We can see this in the serious air and water pollution in many countries, increasing global resource consumption and decreasing availability of resources, in the global rise of CO2 emissions and in many other areas of the environment. At the same time, more than 700 million people are still living in poverty. Our goal has to be to ensure everyone can lead a life in dignity without hunger or poverty. This is a central commitment of the 2030 agenda. I fully support the UNEA president and the new and incoming UN Environment Executive Director in their call to us at this UN Environment Assembly to seek innovative solutions for these challenges. We need to rethink production and consumption patterns and make them more effective and resource efficient. Everyone has a right to strive for prosperity, but we must ensure that this is not at the expense of the environment and climate. Apart from sustainable consumption patterns, innovations are needed. Industry has a key role to play here. At the same time, policymakers are responsible for creating the right framework conditions and incentives. This is why the German Environment Ministry has set up a new program in 2018 for the decarbonization of industry. This program promotes pilot projects for the industrial transition to largely greenhouse gas neutral production. The intention is to avoid short-sighted investments and capital losses and expensive retrofitting. Innovations can drive environmentally harmful technologies from the market. One example is the coal-fired electricity generation, which in many countries is steadily losing ground to renewable-based electricity. We are facing in Germany the same challenges. We are still dependent to a large extent on coal electricity production. To overcome this, we have agreed in the German government to set up a commission to advise us how to get out of coal and at the same time do it in a just way, to do it in a just transition way. And this was a successful way. The multi-stakeholder commission advised us to get out of coal at the latest by 2038 and if ever possible, already earlier by 2035, and the government in Germany has decided to do so. So the latest in 2038, Germany will be a non-nuclear and a non-coal-based economy. I'm delighted that UNEA4 we can contribute to driving forward the fair and fast transition that is needed. And this requires partnerships. The only way to tackle the challenges is through cross-sectoral and cross-boundary cooperation. With this in mind, I would like to conclude with an invitation. Germany will be hosting the International Conference on Climate Action, known as ICA 2019 in Heidelberg, on 22nd and 23rd May. We want to bring together all stakeholders, and I would appreciate to see a lot of you, many of you, at this conference in Heidelberg. Thanks a lot.
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre. Joachim, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent Monsieur le ministre délégué Jassim Al-Mohamedi de l'Environnement et de la Santé de l'Irak. Monsieur le ministre, vous avez la parole.
Sayyid al-Rais, Sayyidat wa Sad al-Hadour, Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. Yu'ayyid wafd biladi. البيان الذي ألقاه مندوب سلطنة عمان نيابة عن مجموعة آسيا والمحيط الهادئ واسمحوا لي أن أتقدم بالشكر والامتنان لكل الجهود التي بذلت من أجل انعقاد أعمال هذه الجمعية والتي تعقد في ظل تحديات بيئية عالمية كبيرة أبرزها تسارع وتيرة الآثار السلبية كنتيجة حتمية لزيادة الاحتباس الحراري المسبب لتغير المناخ والجفاف والتصحر والتلوث والاختلال الكبير في التوازن البيئي هذه التحديات تشكل دافعاً وحافزاً لمناقشة واعتماد قرارات من شأنها وضع مقترحات وحلول لمواجهة تلك التحديات تتناغم مع وتحقق أهداف التنمية المستدامة وأجندة 2030 إن بلادي ترحب وتدعم شعار حلول مبتكرة للتحديات البيئية ومن أجل الاستهلاك والإنتاج المستدامين
كل مشروع قرار من شأنه المساعدة على مواجهة الأزمات خصوصا تداعيات الأمن الغذائي والحد من التدهور البيئي وترحب على وجه الخصوص بمشروعي قرار المجموعة العربية بشأن الهدر والفاقد من الطعام وإدارة النفايات الصلبة. السيدات والسادة، يقوم العراق ورغم ظروفه الصعبة في تنفيذ القرار الخاص بتضرر البيئة في مناطق النزاعات والذي تم إقراره خلال اجتماعات جمعية الأمم المتحدة للبيئة في دورتها الثالثة عام 2017، فقد أجريت وزارة الصحة والبيئة التقييم البيئي الأولي لمناطق النزاعات ومناطق الصناعة النفطية في منطقة القيارة ومعمل كبريت المشراق في المحافظات المتأثرة لتحديد أنواع وكميات وتراكيز الملوثات الناتجة من تضرر هذه المناطق بعد تحريرها من كيان داعش الإرهابي، كما أقيمت العديد من ورش العمل لبناء القدرات في مجال التقييم البيئي والمعالجة للمناطق الملوثة والإدارة البيئية المتكاملة للإنقاذ. وهنا لابد من تقديم الامتنان إلى برنامج الأمم المتحدة للبيئة لتقديمه الدعم الفني لهذه النشاطات، وقد بدأنا بصورة جدية في اعتماد الطاقات المتجددة والتخلص من النفايات التي كانت من ضمن أولويات وثيقة المساهمات الوطنية العراقية والتي قدمت إلى أمانة اتفاقية الأمم المتحدة لتغير المناخ. إن بلادي حريصة على إعادة تأهيل واستدامة القطاع البيئي الذي يعد من القطاعات الهشة نتيجة لما تعرض له من عمليات إرهابية استهدفت كل مجالات الحياة ومنها البيئة، مضافا إليها قلة تدفق المياه في نهري دجلة والفرات وهو ما يهدد النظام البيئي للعراق بشكل عام والموائل الطبيعية وما تحتويه من تنوع بيولوجي بشكل خاص في أهوار جنوب العراق التي أدرجت عام 2017 على لائحة التراث العالمي، العفو عام 2016. كما لا يخفى ما لتغير المناخ والتصحر والجفاف وما يتبعها من عواصف غبارية ورملية ذات تأثيرات سلبية خطيرة تسببت في انحسار الإنتاج الزراعي والذي أحال العراق من بلد مصدر أو مكتفي ذاتيا إلى مستورد للكثير من المحاصيل الزراعية. ونؤكد هنا بهذا الصدد ضرورة دعم الدول الأكثر هشاشة، ونطلب دعم الدول الأكثر هشاشة والتي منها العراق وتحقيق العدالة المناخية والدعوة للالتزام بمبدأ المسؤولية المشتركة المتباينة وحسب القدرات لمواجهة التحديات الدولية البيئية وفق التوقعات البيئية الدولية الجي او وبما ينسجم مع تحقيق أهداف التنمية المستدامة 2030 وتعزيز استخدام الطاقات النظيفة والمتجددة والمستدامة ومبادئ حقوق الإنسان وتحقيق التوازن الجنساني ومكافحة الفقر وتحقيق العدالة الاجتماعية وتعزيز دور القطاع الخاص ومنظمات المجتمع المدني. نتمنى لأعمال هذه الجمعية النجاح وندعم قراراتها التي تراعي وتدعم الوضع البيئي خصوصا في الدول ذات الوضع الهش وندعو.
Merci monsieur le ministre Jassim pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent monsieur le ministre Afioga Taifu Lemi Lemalu des ressources naturelles et de l'environnement de Samoa à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole monsieur le ministre.
Mr. President, the sixth annual environment outlook has confirmed our worst fear. The overall environment situation is deteriorating at an unprecedented pace. Our planet is increasingly polluted, rapidly warming, and quickly losing its biodiversity due to climate change and uncontrollable production and consumption patterns. Left unchecked, this situation will pose serious consequences for the most vulnerable. This is the alarming reality of resource-constrained, small island developing state like mine, whose efforts towards environment conservation and sustainable development are hindered given our circumstances and vulnerabilities. The theme of our assembly is a timely wake-up call that challenges all of us to live within and think beyond in search of innovative solutions to our own self-inflicting problems. Our 2030 development agenda is to ensure that economic, social, and technological progress occurs in harmony with nature. This requires member states to act collectively to mitigate the consequences of uncontrolled pursuit of development gains at the expense of environment. Mr. President, the Samoa pathway is the blueprint of SIDS sustainable development agenda and is subject to review in September this year. Preparatory meetings held so far have pointed to implementation gaps in the conservation and sustainable use of oceans and seas, sustainable management of chemicals and hazardous waste,
and sustainable consumption and production. Pollution from electricity generation, transportation and industrial processes is another growing concern. To address these challenges, SEED look to this assembly for empathy, not sympathy, for understanding, not grandstanding. Mr. President, Samoa continues to fulfill its obligation under the Rio Convention and other multilateral framework, including the 2030 Development Agenda and the Samoa Pathway. We have localized and integrated this cross-sectorially in our national development strategy and implemented it through partnership with relevant stakeholders nationally and beyond. Mr. President, the UNEP Pacific Office was established in Samoa in September 2014 as one of the concrete deliverables of the UN SEEDS Conference. The office has brought UNEP closer to our Pacific countries, increased its relevance, and enhanced our engagement in its work program. The three-staff team is under extreme pressure to address the diverse needs and expectations of our member countries. This situation must be resolved to better position this office to manage the regional challenges more effectively. Finally, the environmental challenges is a global problem requiring global solution. Some like marine waste, plastic litter across national borders and maritime boundaries uninvited. Our assembly's theme requires implementable action on the ground where all action matters and none too small, inferior, or inconsequential. It is why Samoa has taken a bold move to ban single-use plastic effective January this year to try and tackle this pressing environmental challenge, which is not of our making. Nationally and regionally, Mr. Chairman, we will not be able to solve this problem on our own, but collectively we can. Will your countries be willing to follow suit? I thank you.
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre Atioga, pour votre déclaration. J'invite maintenant le ministre Mokhtar Babayev de l'Environnement de l'Azerbaïdjan. Monsieur le ministre, vous avez la parole.
Я заменяю нашего министра здесь.
Thank you.
Уважаемый господин председатель, уважаемые участники ассамблеи, дамы и господа, прежде всего позвольте выразить глубокое соболезнование в связи с авиакатастрофой, произошедшей в Эфиопии, которая наряду с многочисленными жертвами унесла жизнь сотрудников Организации Объединенных Наций. Позвольте также выразить глубокую признательность правительству Республики Кения и программе Организации Объединенных Наций по окружающей среде за прекрасные организации 4-й сессии Ассамблеи Организации Объединенных Наций по окружающей среде. Охрана окружающей среды и рациональное использование природных ресурсов является важной составной частью проводимых в нашей стране реформ. Экологические проблемы постоянно находятся в центре внимания руководства страны. Хочу отметить, что согласно распоряжению президента Азербайджанской Республики, в 2012 году была утверждена концепция развития «Азербайджан-2020. Взгляд в будущее». Данная стратегия предусматривает развитие экономики Азербайджана, основанные на принципах устойчивого развития и включает в себе комплексные унификации экономических, социальных и экологических компонентов. В 2017 году в рамках политического форума высокого уровня ООН был представлен добровольный национальный отчет Азербайджана об осуществлении целей устойчивого развития. В настоящее время готовится второй добровольный национальный отчет, который будет представлен в этом году. В 2016 году была утверждена стратегическая дорожная карта для национальной экономики и основных секторов экономики с целью устойчивого, конкурентоспособного развития ненефтяного сектора страны. Стратегическая дорожная карта включает стратегию экономического развития и план действий на 2016-2020 годы, долгосрочные программы на период до 2025 года, а также силовые программы на период после 2025 года. За последние 10-15 лет площадь покрытия лесами увеличивалась с 11 и 4 до 12% от общей территориальной территории страны. Проводятся крупномасштабные проекты по озеленению аридных и семиаридных территорий. Азербайджан подписал Парижское соглашение Рамочной конвенции ООН об изменении климата и поставил амбициозные цели сократить выбросы парниковых газов в атмосфере на 35% до 2030 года по сравнению с уровнем базового 1990 года. Предпринимаются усилия по уменьшению выбросов парниковых газов. В 2018 году была принята национальная стратегия по улучшению управления твердым отходом в Азербайджанской Республике на 2018 и 2022 года. Одним из основных ожидаемых результатов реализации стратегии является улучшение процессов сбора, транспортировки, переработки, утилизации твердых отходов. Более того, был утвержден план мероприятий по снижению негативного воздействия отходов пластиковых упаковочных материалов на окружающей среде на 2019-2020 годы. Данный план предусматривает меры по усовершенствованию системы управление отходом пластиковой упаковки и расширение использования альтернативных материалов. В настоящее время азербайджане осуществляют различные проекты в области охраны окружающей среды.
Merci. Je vous remercie pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent monsieur le ministre délégué Slavomir Mazurek de la Pologne, ministre de l'Environnement, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, monsieur le ministre.
Excellences, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to be here and deliver the statement on behalf of the Republic of Poland. I would like to express our deepest condolence to the families of the victims of the tragedy in Ethiopia. Our prayers with you. Last year in December, my country hosted the 24th session climate conference. After the 2 weeks of intense negotiation, the international community success in agreeing the procedures and the rules necessary to make the Paris Agreement alive. Katowice rulebook. Katowice rulebook was adopted and gave the government and non-party stakeholders tools to act effectively for the sake of the climate neutrality. It's to believe that the Environmental Assembly here in the Nairobi will result on the crucial decision to advance the sustainable development. Distinguished colleagues, Poland persuades sustainable development to the protection of the environmental as the key priority. Therefore, we actively engage the Global Forum in actions towards the protection of the climate, biodiversity, towards preventing desertification and pollution, as well as towards tackling the problem of the water scarcity. Poland, country with quite a recent socio-economic transformation, understand very well that the challenge is to maintain the balance between the GDP growth and the sustainable management of resources. We have managed to decouple our economic growth from uncontrolled pressure on the environment. However, we still recognize the need of the future action towards more innovative solutions, and they need to act jointly with the other nation and all interested stakeholders. We like to devote a few words of the Polish experience in this regard. It is responsibility of the government to diagnose the most important barriers for the sustainable development, and based on that, the draft of implementation approaches national regulatory framework, which aim of the achieving sustainable development goals. Therefore, we have started a transition from the linear to circular economy. The circular economy is crucial discussion now. One of the goals is to steer Polish economy towards level depends from the non-renewable resources. Consequently, we work towards increasing the share of the renewable resources as well as stimulate sustainable consumption and the production. It is parent could be great through education and awareness raising, focusing on building environmental social responsibility. Let me mention just two concrete examples. In Poland, we have noticed a great potential to strengthen action of the small municipalities and the communities in transition toward the circular economy. Therefore, we launched a pilot program which focused on public education and building the local capacity. It will be support investment in the waste management, building the sustainability, mobility, resources, efficiency, circular models in households of agriculture, and sustainable use of the land. Another example, it is the wood construction project, which drives from proven solution from the past. Its main goal is build eco-friendly wooden houses, mainly for the people who cannot afford to buy their own apartment. Such house needs approximately 30% less heat than conventional construction and
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre Slavomir, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent Monsieur le Ministre Park Chung-kyu de la République de Corée, ministre de l'Environnement, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole.
Mr. President, Excellencies, distinguished delegates, let me begin by thanking UNEP for organizing this excellent session and also congratulating on the 6th GEO report successfully launched yesterday. The message this report gives us is utterly simple. It calls for a change. A change the way we produce, change the way we consume, and change the way we think and live. To make that change happen, innovation is not a matter of choice, but a must. To bring out the best innovative power from ourselves, I believe there are three polished dimensions that should be explored by governments. First, a strong policy framework. Second, innovative policy tools. And third, a robust governance. A strong policy framework is often represented by laws. Last year, Korea enacted a framework act on resource circulation to move away from the linear economy defined by take, make, waste cycle to a circular economy. Even the most powerful framework, however, will be of no use if it is not implemented. Effective policy tools, such as green card program, can encourage consumers to adopt sustainable consumption patterns in a smart way. The program was introduced in 2011 in Korea to incentivize consumers to purchase eco-friendly products, use public transport, and save energy. As environment and SCP agenda are highly cross-cutting, an integrated governance is most important to ensure policy coherence, inter-agency collaboration, and public-private partnership. Last December, the Korean government has established Korean Sustainable Development Goals to build this governance. In the goal-setting process, civil society groups, experts from various fields, and government bodies participated. Indeed, setting the right governance at a national level is important. But as today's environmental challenges have no boundaries, we also need a strong international partnership to tackle many urgent global environment issues such as climate change and transboundary air pollution. Excellencies, certainly innovative solutions cannot be attained with government interventions alone. A culture that fosters sustainability and communities' joint effort to move beyond the throwaway culture should be accompanied. Let me finally reaffirm that Korea remains as a strong partner in shaping their culture for a sustainable future. Thank you for your attention.
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre Park, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent Monsieur le Vice-ministre Zhao Yingmin de la République populaire de Chine à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, Monsieur le Ministre.
尊敬的主席先生，女士们、先生们，首先我代表中国代表团，感谢联合国环境署和肯尼亚政府为这次会议所做出的精心筹备，同时我也要向哀航悲剧中所有的罹难者家属表示沉痛的哀悼。形成可持续消费和生产方式是推动生态文明建设和绿色发展的重要内容。 为此，中国政府发布实施了一系列的政策措施，取得积极的进展。一是不断优化经济结构，推动高质量发展，降低生产活动对资源环境的压力。目前，中国的最终消费和服务业对经济增长的贡献率达到了76%和60%。高技术产业、装备制造业增速明显，单位 GDP 的能耗和污染物的排放强度持续的降低。二是对工业产品、建筑、食品实施节能环保标志认证制度，提供绿色产品和服务供给。2017年，全国环境标志产品的产值达到了近6000亿美元。三是实施政府绿色采购制度。2017年，中国政府采购的节能环保产品占到了同类产品采购规模的91%。第四是实施绿色金融和税收优惠政策。2018年末，中国的绿色贷款余额达到了1.2万亿美元，同比增长了16%。五是创新技术，鼓励消费的新业态的发展。目前，中国拥有世界最大的新能源汽车产量和风电与太阳能的装机容量，有4亿多网民通过互联网完成日常的消费采购。共享经济发展迅速，全国共享单车的投放量超过了2500万辆。六是通过提高公民意识，发布行为规范，倡导形成节能、节水、节电和生活垃圾分类等绿色的生活方式。女士们、先生们，独行者速，众行者远，改善全球环境需要各国戮力同心、同心合作。我们期待着与各方携手努力，共同构建人类命运共同体，建设清洁美丽的地球家园。谢谢。
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre Zhao, pour vos déclarations. J'invite maintenant le ministre, le secrétaire d'État Tibor Zoltán László de la Hongrie à faire sa déclaration. Monsieur le secrétaire d'État, vous avez la parole.
Tisztelt elnök úr, excellenciák, hölgyeim és uraim! Nagy megtiszteltetés, hogy a magyar kormány képviseletében részt vettek az ENSZ legmagasabb környezetvédelmi fórumán, és tevékenységéhez kifejezhetem támogatásunkat. Nagyra értékeljük az UNEA 4 elnökének eredményorientált megközelítését, és az UNEP titkárság, valamint a delegáció kemény munkáját annak érdekében, hogy ez sikerüljön. Magyarország környezetpolitikájának határozott célja, hogy az ország gazdasági fejlődése, a természeti erőforrások és értékek megőrzése, valamint fenntartható hasznosítása mellett menjen végbe. Ez iránt komoly és határozott elköteleződésünket számos tevékenység, törekvés bizonyítja hazai és nemzetközi szinten. Magyarország az ENSZ 3. környezetvédelmi közgyűlésén több olyan vállalást is tett, amelyek szorosan kapcsolnak az UNEA 4 kiemelt témájához, azaz innovatív megközelítéssel próbálnak a környezeti kívásokra reagálni és a fenntartható fogyasztásra és termelésre ösztönözni. Csak néhány példát említenék. Bár Magyarországon az élelmiszer hulladék kevesebb, mint az EU országok átlaga, további intézkedéseket teszünk. Az önkéntes felajánlások alapján működő Magyar Élelmiszerbank Egyesülettel való együttműködés mellett nagy hangsúlyt fektetünk a szemletformálásra is, célul kitűzve az élelmiszer hulladék legalább 10%-os csökkentését 2020-ig. Kiemelten támogatjuk a helyi élelmiszertermelést és a termelőpiacok hálózatának bővítését. Rövid ellátási láncok, a szállítási igények csökkentése révén mérséklik a környezeti terhelést, és hozzájárulnak a helyi munkahelyteremtéshez is. A kormány által 2016-ban elfogadott Nemzeti Erdőstratégia alapján átfogó erdőtelepítési programot valósítottunk meg. 2000 óta működő zöld óvoda és ökoiskola programunk kora gyerekkortól támogatja a fenntarthatóságra nevelést. E célból támogatjuk az iskolakertek létesítését is. Az országos fűcsokosan kampány során információkkal látjuk el a lakosságot, és tanácsot adunk, hogyan fűthetnek környezetkímélőbb módon. Magyarország aktív nemzetközi együttműködést folytat, hiszen a világ legnemzetközibb vízgyűjtőjének közepén helyezkedik el, 7 ország által körülvéve, és felelősen gondoskodik a környezeti problémák globális kezeléséről is. A Kárpátok keretegyezmény soros elnökeként ki szeretnénk emelni az UNEP Bécsi irodájának szerepét, mint UNEP szubregionális jelenlétének kiváló példáját. A globális fenntarthatósági vízcél megvalósításának támogatása érdekében idén októberben Magyarországon harmadszor rendezi meg a Budapest Víz világtalálkozót, most a vízválság megelőzését helyezve a középpontba. Hölgyeim és uraim, végezetül sok sikert kívánok az ENSZ Agenda 2030 megfogalmazott környezetvédelmi célkitűzésének teljesüléséhez, ami csak felelős gondolkodással és összefogással valósítható meg minden szinten. Bízom abban, hogy ehhez a mostani környezetvédelmi közgyűlés ambiciózus eredményekkel járul hozzá. Köszönöm a megtisztelő figyelmüket.
Merci, monsieur le ministre, pour votre déclaration. J'invite maintenant le vice-ministre Julio Recinos de l'Environnement du Guatemala à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, monsieur le ministre.
Thank you. Señor presidente, sus excelencias, el presidente de Guatemala, señor Jimmy Morales, colocó entre sus cinco ejes de trabajo el tema ambiental. Y por esa razón, entre los objetivos del Ministerio de Ambiente y del señor ministro Alfonso Alonso, han emprendido acciones muy importantes en este tema, entre los cuales están agua y saneamiento. Por disposición del señor presidente de la República, del presupuesto de los consejos de desarrollo, el 60% se destinó para implementación de proyectos de agua y saneamiento, priorizado desde las comunidades. Se trabaja también con alcaldes municipales con la finalidad que se destine un alto porcentaje de su presupuesto para plantas de tratamiento en aguas residuales. Cuando inició esta administración, habían 40 plantas de tratamiento. Hoy, con el acompañamiento del Ministerio de Ambiente, hay más de 250 plantas de tratamiento y existen 500 estudios de prefactibilidad. Como soluciones innovadoras de bajo costo, se implementó la tecnología artesanal llamada biobardas, colocadas en más de 250 ríos del país, que sirven para tener los desechos y residuos sólidos que corren en el espejo del agua, logrando detener aproximadamente el 75% de plásticos, equivalentes a miles de toneladas al año, evitando así la contaminación de mares, playas y océanos. Esta tecnología barata se ha compartido con países hermanos. De estas biobardas dejamos un folleto en el escritorio de cada uno de ustedes, sus excelencias. Hemos realizado también alianzas público-privadas con convenios con los sectores del monocultivo de caña de azúcar y palma africana para que dentro de sus cultivos establezcan corredores biológicos y bosques de galería para contribuir a la recuperación y conservación de la biodiversidad. Recuperación y conservación del paisaje forestal. Guatemala asumió el reto de Bonn y estamos trabajando arduamente para lograr ese compromiso. Para ello, hemos firmado convenios con diferentes sectores de sociedad civil, tales como organizaciones de mujeres, personas de la tercera edad, jóvenes, etc. Y ahora estamos capacitándolo mediante diplomados relacionados con la restauración, el cambio climático, etc. Es más, mediante el Instituto Nacional de Bosques, contamos con más de 38,000 proyectos de siembra y manejo de bosques privados. En ese sentido, excelentísimas excelencias, Guatemala, no obstante de ser uno de los países que menos contaminación por gases de efecto invernadero produce, somos uno de los países, de los 10 países más vulnerables del mundo. Y pedimos entonces a esta Asamblea y a los países donantes mayor apoyo económico y acompañamiento de tecnología para resolver nuestra problemática. Muchas gracias.
Merci, monsieur le ministre, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent le ministre délégué Vladislav Zmirs de l'Environnement de la République de Tchécoslovaquie à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, monsieur le ministre.
Merci, monsieur le président de la République tchèque, ne pas Tchécoslovaquie.
Anyway, Your Excellency, Ministers, ladies and gentlemen, it's my honor and pleasure to address you on behalf of the Czech Republic here at the Primary Forum on Global Environmental Issues. Let me start by congratulating the UNEA Bureau President for his leadership and the preparation of this event. This year, we are addressing a topic which I believe goes to the very heart of our human nature on this planet. Within this forum, we have been able to discuss and agree upon a number of its elements that we believe to be of utmost importance, such as how we can better design our economies and our societies in the achievement of the 2030 agenda and decent future of all, including innovative approaches such as circular economy. We also covered further improvements in the management of chemicals and waste in various forms, recovery of ecosystems and biodiversity, or expand action on climate. As a country, we have indeed been committed to tackle some of these very issues in support of the theme of the last assembly, but with continuing relevance of our current agenda, we have launched a successful campaign which has brought together the government, private enterprises, municipalities, and consumers in the effort to eliminate single-use plastics. We are currently in the final stages of passing a new waste bill, which will help us eventually eliminate landfilling and promote circular approaches. On that note, we are also underway with the development of a national strategy for circular economy. I'm listing these few as a show of our sincere and commitment to this agenda, but I could go on. Of course, that doesn't mean that we see our work as finished. Tomorrow, at the same time as we conclude this meeting, our high school students have decided to go on strike with a call for more decisive action on climate and swifter transition toward a sustainable global economy and society. Their action gives us both motivation to continue our efforts and hope for a better future. Same as we have recognized continuing work ahead of ourselves, we are looking forward to further improvement in the way the United Nations Environmental Programme races to the challenges of its mandate under the leadership of the new Executive Director, Madame Inger Andersen. This is the key if it's to deliver on the Agenda 2030, for which, as we know, protection and management of the environment is an absolute foundation. I thank you for your attention.
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre Vladislav de la République de Tchèque. J'invite à présent le parlementaire du Japon, Takaki Katsumata, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, Excellence.
Honorable ministers and all the distinguished participants, I am honored to deliver a statement representing the government of Japan. First of all, I express my deepest condolences to the victims and their families of a tragic airplane accident a few days ago. First, to combat marine plastic litter, the important thing is how to prevent plastic leakage into the ocean. There is absolutely no need to restrain our economic activities. All the nationals and stakeholders must work together on such measures as sound waste management, recovery of marine litter, 3Rs, innovation, and international cooperation. In this union session, Japan is proposing to immediately take action to enhance scientific knowledge and continue to consider a wide range of response options in solving this problem. Japan has announced its decision to make financial contributions to the establishment of a regional knowledge hub and the implementation of a UNEP-led research project both in the Asian region. Second, every effort in relation to sustainable consumption and production must be expedited. We are currently examining a plastic resource circulation strategy that includes a 25% reduction milestone for single-use plastics and introduction of mandatory plastic bag fees. Furthermore, our industry is refraining from the use of microbeads in wash of cosmetics on a voluntary basis. Japan organized the World Circular Economy Forum with Finland last October, and will continue to share best practices with the world. In this union session, we are proposing to invite all stakeholders to promote awareness rising on resource efficiency and circular economy. Lastly, we are working to create a circulating and ecological economy to form self-reliant and decentralized society. As this year's G20 chair, Japan is determined to achieve a virtuous circle of environmental protection and economic growth through innovation. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Merci, Excellence, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent le vice-ministre Dr. Bishop Edward Shomba de la Zambie à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, Monsieur le ministre.
Mr. President, Excellences, we are immensely grateful that you considered to be part of you and you part of us. As we begin to share together, Zambia wants to join everybody else to convey our grammar of sympathy to our fallen colleagues who passed on a few days ago. Mr. President, it gives me great pleasure, and it being monolithic now, that I can share in the theme of our gathering today, innovative solutions to environmental challenges and sustainable consumption of production. Zambia recognizes that the environmental challenges are immense and negatively affect socio-economic development globally. However, we are also cognizant of the fact that opportunities exist to deal with these environmental challenges, and if we can do it collectively. In this regard, Zambia's government considers this gathering very crucial, as it will help member states to advise mechanisms to deal with multiple environmental challenges facing the globe today. Allow me, Mr. President, to share with you some of the innovative solutions to environmental challenges implemented by my government in line with this year's theme. Zambia has issued a statutory instrument number 65, which we call Extended Producer Responsibility. In accordance with the provision of the Environmental Management Act, this is, in essence, we have regulated and banned the make and the use of carrier bags that are 30 microns and below. I am proud to inform you that this, my government is vigorously enforcing this innovative solution. This is, of course, in line with making a program that we call in Zambia, Keeping Zambia Clean, Green, and Healthy, that is superintended by our president, President Edgar Lungu. Number two, Mr. President, in Zambia we always believe that, you know, through, you know, working together, the act is expanded to enhance solid waste management, is also has been enacted in Parliament. This is at the core of the legislation and development of the innovative strategies promote investment in solid waste management. We believe that other people's rubbish could be other people's bread, where we'll be able to recycle the harmful and wasteful materials that pollute our environment. On climate change, Mr. President, government has scaled up the implementation of renewable energies. Just 2 days ago, the President of the Republic of Zambia, President Lungu, commissioned a 54-megawatt solar power plant project that is supported by the World Bank Group. This project is expected to power over 30,000 houses and will have the lowest tariffs on sub-Saharan Africa at 6 cents per kilowatt hour. Furthermore, Zambia has launched also a Plant a Million Tree initiative, and this has been ongoing. Mr. President, these climate change mitigation actions and other innovative solutions to environmental challenges are being implemented in line with the provisions of the national policy on climate change national policy on environment, the Vision 2030, and other strategies adopted by my government to foster socio-economic development. We need to collectively work together to develop robust and domestic policy systems and guidelines for environmental assessment, audits, monitoring, and evaluation.
Merci, Monsieur le Ministre, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent Madame le Secrétaire d'État Brune Poirson de la transition écologique et solidaire de la France. Madame le Secrétaire d'État, vous avez la parole.
Mesdames et Messieurs les ministres, je voudrais commencer mon intervention en disant qu'au nom de la France, je souhaite saluer la nomination d'Inge Andersen à la tête de cette institution et par là même réitérer le soutien crucial et important de la France aux Nations Unies. L'accord de Paris, c'est le contrat social du 21e siècle. Parce qu'on ne peut pas envisager préserver l'environnement sans se donner les moyens d'offrir à chacun une vie digne et une vie prospère. Et on ne peut pas envisager une société solidaire sans se donner les moyens de lutter contre le changement climatique. L'environnement, le préserver, c'est vrai que c'est lutter contre les émissions de CO2. Mais c'est aussi préserver la nature. Et nous devons donc faire de la préservation de la biodiversité une vraie priorité. Et nous devons aussi nous donner les moyens d'agir. Mais pas agir à la marge en se donnant bonne conscience. En se centrant sur deux choses essentielles, c'est-à-dire transformer la totalité du système financier et économique. Il faut que le système financier se mette au service de l'environnement et il faut aussi que nous transformions notre modèle économique. Qu'attendons-nous pour agir? Comme je le disais, il ne s'agit pas de se donner bonne conscience. Nous avons toutes les connaissances, les technologies, les moyens aussi de financement. Alors il faut agir plus vite. C'est ce que nous essayons de faire humblement avec le One Planet Summit, où nous voulons associer, et nous remercions par là d'ailleurs les Nations Unies, mais aussi tous les partenaires de One Planet Summit, eh bien, nous voulons rassembler tous ceux qui veulent faire plus pour l'environnement. C'est là où se rencontrent, où travaillent ensemble des entrepreneurs, des ONG, des gouvernements, pour faire basculer des pans entiers de notre économie dans la protection de l'environnement. C'est par ce biais-là que nous enverrons un signal à l'ensemble des régulateurs du monde entier que dans certains secteurs économiques, eh bien, nous sommes prêts pour réguler. Et c'est aussi comme ça que nous enverrons un signal à ceux qui sont plus lents, peut-être, à entrer dans l'action, eh bien, qu'il est temps qu'ils le fassent et qu'ils ne peuvent pas rester sciemment au bord du chemin. Pour la France, le multilatéralisme du XXIe siècle, c'est ça. C'est l'action. C'est de nouveaux types de partenariats. C'est transformer le système capitaliste mondial. C'est une dynamique qui transforme les accords internationaux en actions concrètes. Et je voudrais prendre ici un exemple très concret. Par exemple, les climatiseurs qui sont des grands émetteurs de HFC. Ceux qui les produisent, les vendent, les achètent, sont associés à la mise en œuvre de ces engagements. L'amendement de Kigali, inscrit au protocole de Montréal, nous le réalisons ainsi, car les chercheurs et le secteur privé s'engagent à nos côtés pour servir un objectif concret, c'est de nous préserver d'un degré de réchauffement climatique d'ici à la fin du siècle. Les États ne peuvent pas tout, sauf l'essentiel. Convaincre que nous avons les moyens et encore le temps de changer les choses. Et c'est grâce à cette méthode-là que nous pouvons aller plus vite. Et donc protégeons, restaurons, transformons. Protégeons la biodiversité pour nous assurer de notre survie. Restaurons les forêts que nous avons détruites pour les laisser à nos enfants. Transformons nos manières de consommer, de produire, de financer, tant qu'il est encore temps. Plus qu'une devise, faisons de ce triptyque un plan d'action universel. Protégeons, restaurons, transformons.
Merci, Madame le Secrétaire d'État Brune Poirson, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent le chef de la délégation, Aldo Claoré, de la Bolivie, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole. «
Señor presidente de la Cuarta ANUMA, excelencias, autoridades y delegados y delegadas de países hermanos, traemos el saludo de nuestro presidente Evo Morales Ayma y del pueblo boliviano a todos los países y pueblos reunidos acá. Señor presidente, nuestra delegación agradece la hospitalidad del gobierno de Kenia y al mismo tiempo se une al luto por las pérdidas humanas en el accidente de la línea aérea de Etiopía. Expresamos nuestras más sentidas condolencias a sus familias y amistades. Nuestra presencia aquí en la Cuarta ANUMA es parte del compromiso del Estado Plurinacional de Bolivia por la defensa de los derechos de la Madre Tierra en equilibrio con el desarrollo, con el derecho al desarrollo. En la ANUMA 3 dedicamos los esfuerzos a aprobar una ruta crítica hacia un mundo sin contaminación. Hoy debemos profundizar y avanzar sustancialmente en esta reflexión mundial sobre los patrones de consumo y de producción insostenibles que arriesgan la posibilidad de alcanzar un desarrollo integral y sustentable. También debemos avanzar en decisiones que promuevan la transformación estructural de estos procesos porque generan modelos excluyentes y destructivos. Esto es necesario para fortalecer las economías basadas en los derechos de todos y todas en un desarrollo equilibrado, sano, inclusivo y equitativo. Debemos, por tanto, fortalecer la diversidad de modelos económicos sostenibles y que proponen cambios estructurales que priorizan la vida sobre el crecimiento económico y la equidad sobre la exclusión. Sabemos que gran parte de los desafíos ambientales del presente son resultado de procesos históricos, por lo que enfatizamos que tenemos responsabilidades comunes pero diferenciadas y por tanto la colaboración es fundamental en este proceso. Tenemos muchos avances, pero también mucho camino por recorrer en la gobernanza ambiental global. Y para ello hacemos un llamado para fortalecer la sinergia entre las convenciones en el marco de las Naciones Unidas. Alertamos que la ANUMA perderá vigencia y fuerza si sus debates implican retrocesos o inconsistencias con las decisiones ya alcanzadas en los acuerdos internacionales. Convocamos por eso a los países miembros a reconocer de manera más explícita la necesidad de avanzar en la implementación de la Agenda 2030 para el Desarrollo Sostenible. Pedimos al Secretariado de la ANUMA que diligencie dinámicas de debates más equilibradas e inclusivas, que no pongan en desventaja a los países con delegaciones pequeñas, que generalmente son las con mayor diversidad biológica y cultural, con mayores superficies de bosques, fuentes de aguas y otros, y que por tanto tienen una relevancia especial en los debates. Finalmente, señor presidente, saludamos el efectivo reconocimiento de los pueblos indígenas y comunidades locales en diferentes resoluciones de esta ANUMA, y sobre todo celebramos la primera resolución en equidad de género y el derecho humano y empoderamiento de mujeres y niñas en la gobernanza ambiental. Muchas gracias.
Merci monsieur le chef de la délégation de la Bolivie pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent son excellence ambassadeur Abdel Mujin Mohamed Mabrouk de la Ligue des États arabes à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, excellence.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم دعوني بداية أن أبدأ كلمتي هذه بالتعبير عن أبلغ آيات الحزن والتعازي إلى ضحايا الطائرة الأثيوبية المنكوبة ونسأل الله أن يترحمهم ويلهم آلهم الصبر وحسن العزاء الحضور الكريم أرجو أن أغتنم هذه المناسبة للتوجه بالتحية إلى سعادة سيم كاسلر رئيس الدورة على جهوده المقدرة التي بذلها في الإعداد لهذه الاجتماعات المتميزة كما لا تفوتني الإشادة بالقيادة الحكيمة للسيدة جويس ميسيويا في الفترة الماضية والتهنئة موصولة أيضا إلى السيدة أنجر أندرسون على توليها منصب المدير التنفيذي مع تمنياتنا لها بالتوفيق كما يسرني أن أنقل لكم تحيات معالي الأمين العام السيد أحمد أبو الغيط وتمنياته لهذه الدورة الهامة بالنجاح وهي تهدف إلى تحقيق تكامل الجهود العالمية لوضع وتنفيذ الأجندة العالمية للبيئة في إطار هذا المحفل الهام وقد بدأت الدول العربية من خلال جامعة الدول العربية ومجلس وزراء البيئة منذ أكتوبر الماضي في الإعداد لهذه الدورة في اجتماع استثنائي في الأردن، وقد تم هذا بدعم مقدر من برنامج الأمم المتحدة للبيئة عبر مكتب غرب آسيا، حيث تم الاتفاق على موقف عربي موحد من جدول أعمالها وتحديد أولوياتها بحيث تتوافق مع شعار هذه الدورة المعنون الحلول المبتكرة للتحديات البيئية وأنماط الإنتاج والاستهلاك المستدام، مما حدا بالدول العربية للتوافق على أوراق مفاهيمية تضمنتها مشروعي قرارين تم طرحهما على هذه الدورة، الأول حول الحلول البيئية المبتكرة وآليات تقليل الهدر والفاقد في الغذاء بالبلدان ذات المناخ الحار، والذي وافقت جمهورية سريلانكا على تبنيه. كما يتعلق المشروع الثاني بموضوع ذي أولوية للدول العربية وعدد من دول العالم، ألا وهو النفايات الصلبة والحلول البيئية المبتكرة والاستراتيجيات الوطنية والإقليمية لإدارتها، وقد تم إسراؤهما بمداخلات متميزة خلال المفاوضات، ويحدون الأمل في أن تتكاتف الجهود بحيث يتم توفير الموارد المالية لتنفيذها. كما أنتهز هذه السانحة للإشارة إلى الزيارة التي قامت بها بعثة تقصي الأوضاع البيئية إلى الأرض العربية المحتلة في فلسطين، ونأمل أيضاً في تضافر الجهود من أجل توفير الموارد اللازمة لاستكمال عملها ورفع تقريرها. الحضور الكريم، بدأت الجامعة العربية أيضاً بالتعاون مع برنامج الأمم المتحدة للبيئة في مراجعة مذكرة التفاهم من أجل توقيعها بعد انقضاء أجل المذكرة السابقة. كما أنني أود أن أعبر عن موقفي الدول العربية من وثيقة العهد الدولي للبيئة، والذي يؤكد على التمسك بالمبادئ القانونية الدولية الحاكمة للقانون البيئي الدولي، خاصة مبادئ العدل والإنصاف والمسؤولية المشتركة متباينة الأعباء. كما تؤكد
Merci, Excellence, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent le groupe des organisations des syndicats, M. Bert Devel, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole, monsieur.
Work for the Workers and Trade Unions Major Group. We represent 210 million workers worldwide. First of all, the workers' movement would like to express their solidarity with all the people that lost loved ones in the plane crash. Dear delegates, our members are very afraid of the impact of climate change and environmental degradation on their future. We know that there are no jobs on a dead planet, and tomorrow you will see unions walking with the students in many countries everywhere in the world, and they will be asking for ambitious climate measures. However, we do not only take to the streets, we take our responsibility at all levels. From the company floor with active green union reps, in the economic sectors, and in social dialogue processes at national and international level. There is one group of workers I would like to draw your attention to, and that are the men and women working in fisheries and tourism. They see their jobs endangered by massive plastic pollution in our seas and oceans, and they want a binding agreement to stop this pollution. The problem has to be tackled from the oil well to the waste stage. As unions, we ask for decent jobs in this profound transition of all stages of the plastic value chain. Dear delegates, everybody speaks about ambition, action, urgency. But at the same time, we see that emissions and pollution is going up instead of down. One important piece seems to be missing in the negotiations, and that is equity, justice. Taking care in a comprehensive and credible way, the negative impact on the most vulnerable in society on the workers that lose their livelihoods and their jobs is the only way to unlock truly ambitious and effective measures. The unions call this just transition. We kindly urge you to take this just transition into account when you go back to your country to implement the measures we all urgently need. Thank you for your attention.
Merci, monsieur, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent le groupe de la société civile et de la jeunesse, monsieur David Ménéné, à faire sa déclaration. Vous avez la parole.
For this opportunity to speak. My name is David Munene and I am speaking today on behalf of the NGO Major Group, Women and Youth and Children. Distinguished delegates, we are nearing the end of this UNEA. Yet we fear that we will be leaving here with heavy hearts. Whilst many inspiring solutions and examples have been shared throughout this week, too often the negotiations and discussions here have been too shallow. We are bitterly disappointed that there was so much opposition to addressing vital areas such as deforestation, overconsumption, unsustainable agricultural supply chains, and global chemicals pollution. The wording in many resolutions was severely weakened by some of the countries and major commitments dropped. This is a disgrace. The world needs more than empty platitudes and promises of an elusive tomorrow that never comes. In our previous statement, we referred to the world of science and data that we have available telling us that we are at a critical turning point where inaction will lead us to over a cliff edge and beyond a point of no return. Now we have the GO6 report stating clearly that SDG targets on environment will not be met. This means that the promises to ourselves and to our children that they would not be left behind are crumbling in front of our very eyes. We need urgent action and solid commitments for transformative change. If we are to have any chance of staying within the planetary boundaries, weak language and technical mitigation measures are totally unacceptable. Thousands of students in the streets, hundreds of thousands of youth groups and NGOs, including faith-based organizations, are calling on you to establish unity of purpose to address these fatal challenges. Dear Member States, we remain your indispensable partners. Our community is full of dedicated experts and leaders ready to work with you to solve the crisis we face today. However, we need all of us alive to do this. Therefore, we urge you to protect environmental defenders who work on the front line and too often find themselves under attack for standing up for our future. Our planet needs saving. Our children, our youth are assets in securing our biodiversity and the entire human race. The planet's climate and ecosystems will recover once we stop the environmental crisis. Instead of rushing to untested, unverified, and potentially risky human-controlled solutions like geoengineering, we should be focusing on healing the planet. Dare we not forget this as we all head back to our respective homes and families. We are ready to secure all our futures. We urge Member States to truly open the doors to help us help you help the world. Thank you very much.
Merci. Merci, Monsieur Ménéné, pour votre déclaration. J'invite à présent le groupe des agriculteurs, Monsieur Savogeni Rengam, à prendre la parole, faire vos déclarations. Vous avez la parole, Madame.
Thank you, Mr. President, Excellencies, Delegates and Colleagues. I'm Sarojini Rengam from Pesticide Action Network and the Pacific, representing Farmers Major Group. First of all, our condolences to the families and friends who lost loved ones in the Ethiopian Airlines. Farmers Major Group welcomes the resolution on promoting sustainable practices and innovative solutions for curbing food loss and waste, and the resolution on chemicals and waste. As farmers' constituency, we hope for the substantial reduction of food loss and waste and the urgent implementation of the resolution by member states. However, we are concerned that food losses are not being addressed in the industrialized and rich countries in the resolution. We also believe that priority should be given to preventing food losses and wastage at retail level and with consumers. Safe and nutritious food is an important component of health and environment and sustainable food systems and must be prioritized in the resolution in its implementation. Food losses at the level of production due to extreme climate events, privatization, and monopoly control over seeds needs to be strongly emphasized. Meat consumption and production is inextricably linked with adverse effects to the sustainability of food systems, and substantial reduction in their production and consumption is necessary. We would like to suggest an enhanced food production system rooted in agroecology, biodiversity, climate resilient varieties, and traditional seeds and knowledge, and that would address the issue from production level. In developing countries, we have countless examples of private-public partnerships and aimed at enhanced agricultural infrastructure, working against the farmers by increasing costs and reducing incomes. Therefore, it is critical that there is substantial public investment in post-harvest services and all services as well. Regarding the resolution on chemicals and waste, the Farmers Major Group welcomes the need for urgent and resolute action at all levels to implement the 2030 agenda and including an improved enabling framework for the sound management of chemicals and waste. And we welcome the initiative of the High Ambition Alliance on Chemicals and Waste. We call for urgent actions to implement and immediately address the issues of thousands of farmers and agricultural workers poisoned by pesticides and their children and all children unknowingly suffer the adverse health effects and lowered IQ as a result of exposure to chemicals, particularly pesticides. We call for urgent action, including legally binding instruments to address the health and environmental impacts of the use and dumping of highly hazardous pesticides in developing countries, as well as hazardous chemicals. We would like to suggest the inclusion of groups that are most affected by these chemicals and waste, and CSOs, in this High Ambition Alliance so that their concerns are fully addressed. We also.
Merci, Madame, pour votre déclaration. Merci. Nous avons à présent conclu notre liste d'orateurs. Nous en avons eu 44 cet après-midi pour cette belle session plénière. Et je tiens à remercier, à encourager et féliciter particulièrement les interprètes. Vous savez qu'ils ont eu, veuillez applaudir pour les interprètes qui sont en deuil dans l'accident d'avion. Il y a eu 3 interprètes qui ont perdu leur vie et paix à leur âme. Aussi, nous allons lever la séance. Les déclarations nationales continueront demain matin à 10h dans la même salle. Je déclare la séance levée.